Live from Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island, Rollins Sports Productions presents College Football 86. This afternoon, the Spiders of Richmond meet the Rams of Rhode Island. Today's game is brought to you by Lincoln Greyhound Park, the exciting alternative. By Miller High Life, made the American way. And by the Providence Journal Bulletin. Tomorrow's another day, read all about it. Good afternoon, I'm Mike Lyons, along with Rich DeSimone and Mel Najarian. Today, family day in Kingston, and I'm certain that the Ram players would like nothing better than to win their first game in front of their respective family members, but the task at hand will not be an easy one. The Spiders have won two in a row, and they have averaged 48 points in doing so. They are blessed with one of the finest quarterbacks in the East, and senior quarterback Bobby Blyer, who has lived up to all his advanced billing this season, completing 59% of his passes and throwing for 14 touchdowns. His favorite targets, a pair of seniors, tight end John Henry and split end James Church, who are first and second in terms of pass receptions. Church, a 6'2", 180-pound senior, is hauled down 27 for 432 yards and two touchdowns, number 82 on the left of your screen. And Henry is a 6'5", 230-pound senior who is hauled down 35 for 415 yards and a touchdown. He will be wearing a big, bold, red 88 on the road white uniform. The Rams, once again, will attempt to win their first game of the season, coming off a 17-0 loss to Boston University. The Rams' defensive unit will have the unenviable task of stopping a Richmond offense that has been averaging 32 points a game. There is the key. The leader for the defense this afternoon, as he has been all season long, will be senior tackle Phil Mulcahy. Mulcahy, a 6'4", 270-pound senior out of Worcester, Massachusetts. Mulcahy leads the team in tackles with 56. In addition, he has 1.5 sacks. Another key member of the defensive corps is linebacker Jim Happy, who is second on the team in tackles. Happy, a 6'2", 214-pound junior out of New York, New York, with 51 tackles, and he has sacked the quarterback on 4 occasions. That will be a big statistic here this afternoon, Rich DeSimone, how many times they can get to Blyer, because if he's got time, unfortunately, the defensive secondary for the Rams have proven that they can be burned.
That's it in a nutshell. Blyer, if given the time back there, will pick them apart. Probably the best quarterback in the Yankee Conference, and his statistics show it, completing 59% of his passes, 14 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. And let's bring in our broadcast partner, Mal Najarian, to talk a little bit about this Richmond ball club. Offensively, not only a great passing team, but they can run the ball as well with their senior tailback, Greg Grooms.
Well, you're right there, Richard. Richmond has been very well represented in all the Yankee Conference statistical leading categories. They have Grooms and this young man named Matthews, who has come onto the scene like a firefly and really ignited a lot of high-powered offense. They're very, very talented individuals, and they're a big team all around. They have a lot of leverage going for them in that the offensive line is very long, very tall, and they'll be able to hold off the URI defenders coming at them. The running backs are strong, powerful. They do provide a lot of offensive punch, and coupled with the quarterback passing capabilities, they are going to be one explosive team and something to reckon with this afternoon.
Let's go on the other side of the ball and talk about URI's offense. Criticism coming that the team just couldn't keep the old offense passing constantly. Probably true, but I would have to believe it's tough to change an offense, especially after six games all the way and go with, say, a two-back offense, after really you have to live and die with the offense that you set out at the beginning of the year.
Well, you'll see as more coaches or as you become more advanced in the football levels, you can change offensive minimally. You can't go drastically and just revamp an entire offense. I believe that URI could conceivably institute a two-tailback type offense, but maintain the passing philosophy and wean away from the passing strategy and get back into a more balanced offensive attack for the future of URI. But as they have right now, they're going to stick with the pass. They may put some surprises because Griffin is one interesting coach. He's done a lot of things in the past, and I think he's not going to just salvage the season. He's going to end up with some very respectable performances in the next few games.
Again, though, changing the offense is maybe something that would have had to have been done during the preseason time, where you can better evaluate what type of players you have. I don't think he, I think he felt that he had the players to keep the and instill the same offense that he has used in the past.
Well, you never want to just stop and say, okay, the great Earhart's gone, and the Damon Riley's gone, and all these other athletes, the DiMaggio's are gone, and now we got to revamp. You try to recruit athletes who are going to fall right into the same fold and continue on the same capacities that you had previously. Unfortunately, certain things fell by the wayside, certain key injuries, and Farland's an excellent quarterback. He's just not having the timing and the time to throw the ball as he would like to have.
Yeah, a question about Doug Haynes, of course. A lot of potential. Really talked about him a lot last season, trumpeting his play. He's had trouble holding on to the football. If they did go to a two-back offense, would it be possible that a Poirier and a Haynes could do the job there? There isn't really a straight fullback amongst the two.
Well, I think that is the best way to wean yourself away from a passing attack. You just have two tailbacks who are both fairly good receivers who can get into the pass pattern, but yet they can also block for each other if on a run play, and they can do some powerful things, and they can do some diversification in the backfield. Then, as time goes on, if Coach Griffin's views in the next upcoming recruiting season, if they're going to change offensive philosophies, they can go and pick or choose some fullbacks with some extra power, as well as having running backs that can catch the ball in the pass pattern. But I think if they had two tailbacks, they could conceivably diversify their offense without changing the complexity that much.
As we look on the field right now, the respective captains meeting at midfield, the keys in your mind in today's game, what does URI have to do to win this one?
Well, I was viewing the Richmond team up close, and these are real big athletes. Their average height on the interior line is like 6'4", 6'5". They're tall and lanky, and they have a lot of leverage. If they can keep the offense and defensive lines of URI at bay, I think it's going to be a very difficult challenge for the University of Rhode Island Rams. But I believe if URI gets unclocked quickly, they get on track, and they get some scores on the board, which they've been woefully poor at doing. They've only scored, I believe, 8 touchdowns all year. If they can get a couple of scores, I think the intensity that's going to abound because they're 0-6 is going to allow them to perhaps keep Richmond at bay.
Let's take a look at the officials working this afternoon's game. The referee is Joel Goldman. The umpire is Edward Ferrante. The linesman, Ron Marinucci. The line judge is Ray Renart. The field judge, Bill Dixon. The back judge is Jim Sheehan. And the clock operator is George Geyer. The officials, led by Joel Goldman, working this game today. The captains for Richmond, Irwin Matthews, number 1. Pete Machacio, number 67, and Jeff Carcutt, number 95. And for Rhode Island, the tri-captains selected for this game today. Number 1 is defensive corner Ray Williams, number 71, offensive tackle Ed Cuyava, and number 87, we talked about him a great deal in the pregame, Phil Mulcahy. The Spiders have won the toss. They have elected to receive. The crowd's still filing in. We would anticipate a crowd in the neighborhood of between 8 and 10,000 as we close out October here on a beautiful Saturday afternoon, and you're taking a look at the back of 11. Number 11 is Greg Farland, number 24, Jimmy Pratt. They'll figure big if URI is going to win this thing this afternoon.
Richmond's high-powered offense, averaging 32 points a game. Rhode Island giving up 30 points a game. And when's the last time you saw our URI team just barely score in double figures, averaging a mere 10 and change a game? It's shocking.
Taking a look at the Richmond sideline, as I mentioned, this is a club that figured to challenge Delaware for the Yankee Conference title. At this time, they are a good deal behind both New Hampshire and the University of Delaware in their quest of a Yankee Conference championship, and this their first year in the league. This is a club that's come a long way. 3 years ago, when their quarterback, Bobby Blyer, was a freshman, they were 0-10. They redshirted him his freshman year, and then in successive years, they went 3-8, 8-4. 1 year ago, 8-3, and this year, 3-3 through 6 games.
And all three close losses, Mike, we must mention.
The man to kick for the University of Rhode Island, as he has been the case all season long, will be Mike Griffin. And deep to receive for Richmond is Irwin Matthews. 1 week ago, Matthews got off an 87-yard kickoff return. He had two huge runs, the 87-yard kickoff return and a 65-yarder from the line of scrimmage. So that's the man who wants the football. Kick on the far side of the field, well shy. They didn't get him anywhere near him. Picked up by Damon Miller. Miller returns it outside the 30 to the 33-yard line, where it will be first and 10 for the Spiders from that point. First and 10 in Richmond territory at their own. They now mark it at the 34-yard line. Offensively, Blyer will have Irwin Matthews and Greg Grooms alternating at the tailback spot, and they will have T.J. Morgan and Aaron Smith alternating at the fullback. Their wide receivers, Brian Shields, their leading receiver, number 20, to the bottom of your screen. James Church, the split end, number 82. The tight end, number 88, John Henry, to give to the fullback. And he is stacked up shy of the 40-yard line. Hewlett credited with the stop. The ball carrier was Grooms, Greg Grooms, a 6'2", 200-pound senior who has rushed for 518 yards on 99 rushing attempts this year, a couple of touchdowns. He rushed for 178 yards 1 week ago.
One of the top backs in the Yankee Conference. You'll be watching him throughout the day. He's a workhorse and also has the ability to catch the football.
Quarterback is Bobby Blyer, a good one, 6'3", 205-pound senior. The fake to Matthews and the give, or the throw off the right side to Grooms out of the backfield. Grooms run out of bounds by Damon Hewlett along with Ray Williams. Shy, however, of the first down. It will be about a third and three for the Spiders.
Watch Richmond to start out very, very conservatively at start. They're going to want to feel URI out, see if there are any blatant holes in their defense, and they're going to pick up a little faster.
Offensive line from tackle to tackle. You see the backs. Blyer, the fullback, is Morgan and Grooms. As I said, they'll alternate a lot. We'll see a lot of Matthews and Smith as well. Third and two, just underway in Kingston. Off the left side, hit at the line of scrimmage, Grooms. He will be shy of the first down. Jim Happy, the linebacker, 6'2", 214-pound junior out of New York. Second leading tackler on the team, brings him down. It will necessitate a punt. Number 86, a 5'9", 155-pound freshman, Jeff Olivo, coming in to punt it. Twin safeties for the Rams standing at their own 20-yard line. That's 21 is Poyer, and 24 is Jimmy Pratt. In the direction of Poyer at his own 17-yard line. Out to the 25, so the Rams will take over first and 10 from their own 25-yard line.
Incidentally, Mike, Olivo leads the Yankee Conference in punting with 27 punts for 1,113 yards and a 41.2 yards per punt average. That is impressive for college.
37-yard punt that time. Greg Farland, 5'11", 88-pound junior out of Southbridge, Mass. Poyer, the ball carrier, off the right side. Nice hole out close to the 30-yard line. We have not seen much. This is a club that is averaging 1.8 yards per attempt on the ground.
They only had 5 yards total against Boston University last week, and they threw the ball 70 times. Doug Haynes' groin injury must be a little more severe. He's not in the starting lineup, as Chris Poirier just ran that ball and picked up 8 yards.
Stop on the play, credited to Kim Pettis out of the secondary. That's what you want to see if you're a Ram fan. You want to see the backs out of the secondary making the stops. Second down and six, 12:58, first quarter. We are scoreless. Family day in Kingston. Farland to throw. Got a man over the middle. That's Poyer for the first down, out close to the 40-yard line. Tony Butler, once again, the defensive corner, a 5'11", 195-pound sophomore, stopping Poyer. So Poyer picks up the first down on a rushing attempt and then a passing attempt. The Rams own it out close to their own 40-yard line.
Nice play selection. You'll see Farland dropping back, calmly throws the ball with a very nice touch. Poirier catches the ball, holds on with both hands in traffic, gets the first down, and lunges for a couple extra yards.
Downfield to the bottom of your screen, a good close look at Greg Farland. Once again, it's Poyer. And Poyer will get close to 5 yards. Stop that time made by Damon Miller. Miller, a linebacker. He is their leading tackler, number 17. Look for him a lot today. He has 75 tackles and a couple of fumble recoveries.
Poirier is a redshirt freshman, of course, fractured his forearm against Maine. As we take a look at the URI offensive line, and Greg Farland, Haynes not in the starting lineup. Chris Poirier has carried the ball twice and also caught a pass.
Haynes with a groin pull. He will play today, but it's a matter of how much. Second and seven, pickup of three. Overthrown as a nice play defensively there. The intended receiver was Poirier, but coming in to break it up was Troy Gray, and he damaged not only the blockers out there, but got to the intended receiver, Poirier, as well. Nice defensive effort.
There were the URI offensive receivers, of course. Schwab had a big game against BU. Jimmy Muse, Donfield, and Pratt, the wideouts. Pratt, of course, with great speed.
First third down conversion opportunity for the University of Rhode Island. They are faced with a third and seven, 11:44 first quarter. Farland, the quarterback, he sends a receiver wide now as he sends Donfield to the near sideline. Pass is complete, and Muse, I believe, has the first down. So you can understand why Farland wanted Donfield further out. He wanted to take the corner out on the play to allow the receiver to get out there and pick up the first down. First down for the Rams, and a good one.
Something the University of Rhode Island hasn't done is that having an extended drive. They've usually had four plays, and then they've kicked it, and consequently that's given the defense a lot of time on the field, and that's why they've given up so many points. Nice to see URI moving the ball and also showing a little diversity, running the football and throwing it as well, as we see Muse making the reception, lunging for that first down.
Muse came in with 16 receptions for 156 yards. He is a 6'3", 203-pound junior out of Melrose, Massachusetts. First and 10 for the Rams. Their second first down in the contest. Off the left side, nice hole for Poirier and an excellent effort. He has a first down inside the 40-yard line. Tom Coles, number 77, on the stop. But Poirier with a great effort in avoiding several hits, not only at the line of scrimmage, but through the linebacking corps as well.
We'll see again, they're going to institute a draw. Fallen drops back, it's very quick. Poirier, with exceptional eye coordination, can see the opening to the backside, spins inside, makes good headway, breaks a couple of tackles, big first down play, big first down.
Poirier is the tailback. Farland to throw to the far side. He's got Pratt inside the 30-yard line, and the URI offense looks as good as it has all season long. Inside the 30, very close to yet another Ram first down.
This looks like that powerhouse we saw last year, the way they're moving the football and running it as well. Poirier doing a nice job back there. Farland looking very confident right now. He's taking his time back there, not rushing things. That's a credit to him as we look at the Richmond defense quickly, and Gray Miller outstanding at the linebacker spots.
First down, a first down inside the 30. 10:48 in the first quarter. The Rams on a march that began at their own 25-yard line. The defensive alignment, a 3-4 defense employed by the Spiders. Off the left side, nice hole for Poirier, and Poirier picks up yet another big chunk of real estate. Rafe Wilkinson, a linebacker on the stop defensively for Richmond.
Simple quick opener. It seems to just be a straight dive. They're catching the Richmond defensemen holding their ground. Good blocking up front by Cuyava, and he breaks a couple of more tackles again for a big 6-yard gain. So they're really doing a good job up front right now.
Second and four at the 23-yard line. Sellinger and Cuyava are the tackles. Jansen and Levy are the guards. Palermo, the offensive center. The pitch to Poirier off the right side. Inside the 20, close to the 16-yard line. And that should be enough for yet another Ram first down. Troy Gray defensively for Richmond, and they are certainly being pressed here early. I think they're a bit shocked at this point. They came in a prohibitive 21.5-point favorite.
I know Chris Poirier has only gained 62 yards in this entire season, 16 carries.
He may have this on this march. And Greg Farland as well, most impressive, 3 of 4 for 26 yards on the drive. First and 10, overthrown. The intended receiver was Donfield, covered well on the far side of the field.
Brian
by
Jordan.
Number 34, Richmond, Brian Jordan.
Good coverage there. It would have been a tough pass reception to make. He was really blanketed.
Football at the 16, and I'll tell you what.
the banged-up Bobby Donfield coming back to the huddle, putting him together with some adhesive tape before the game. He's really taken a beating.
Have to be impressed with the Rams here early. Donfield spread to the lower portion of your screen. At the top, 24 is Pratt. Pratt, the intended receiver, and the pass just beyond his outstretched fingertips, covering on the play defensively, Tony Butler. So now they'll be faced with a third and long, third and 10, as a result of two incompleted passes.
This is where URI has to not press and get unraveled. They're in good position right now. If they can get a first down or a good chunk of real estate again, they can get a field goal, get on the board first. They can't press. They can't have mistakes in scoring territory, and this is one of the biggest problems they've had all season long.
Once again, Donfield and Pratt remain the wide receivers. Single running back is Poyer, playing for the injured Doug Haynes. Farland to throw. Football up in. No, knocked out of the hands of Donfield. Nice work defensively by Brian Jordan. He would have been well shy of the first down. However, we have a flag, I believe.
Okay, Farland again throwing the ball with a little bit of zip on the ball, throwing it to Donfield, who's unable to hold on to the ball. Now, we don't know if any injuries that Donfield sustained, whether he could have held on to the ball if he was as healthy as he was. Now, I don't know what the penalty is. It seems as though it may be a
legal use of the hands, it looked like, on the URI offensive unit.
And there's, again, the mistakes that I said, that possibly it's declined, and they're going for fourth down. Again, this is a break for them because they're probably going to go for the field goal and, again, try to get on the scoring board early.
Chris Poyer in that drive, 5 rushes for 34 yards. As Rich mentioned, he has about 65 on the year, so an excellent start for the afternoon here for the freshman, the redshirt freshman out of Narragansett, Rhode Island. In the try, the field goal will be Mike Griffin. The kick will come from the 23-yard line, a 33-yard attempt. The kick is up, and it is no good. It is wide of the mark, and you could tell the excellent end zone view there showed, I think, quite well the situation, as Griffin was wide with the boot, so the game remains scoreless. Unfortunate, because that was an excellent drive put together by the Rams.
It's a beautiful drive. It's demoralizing, to say the least, to move the ball so effortlessly and then not come up with any points.
As you take a look at a very dejected Mike Griffin on the sideline, son of the coach, Griffin, a sophomore, 5'8", 160-pound sophomore, makes his home, of course, with his dad in Narragansett. Ball carriers, Grooms, off the left side. Line of scrimmage was the 20. He gets a chunk of 5, tackled by Phil Mulcahy, the leading tackler for the Rams. Once again, remember, Grooms comes in averaging about 5 yards a carry. He picked up just over 5. It will be 2nd and 5, football at the 25.
Second to Maine's Doug Dorsey in rushing. Dorsey, an outstanding back.
This is the URI mascot. Now we're back to the field.
He's a little somber, too, at the moment as a result of the missed field goal. Blyer with plenty of time. He gives it off on the draw play inside. The ball carrier was Grooms, and he got close to the first down. Gilman, the nose tackle, 6'1", 281-pound freshman. The defensive line, Gilman in the middle, Landry and Mulcahy at the tackles. Kurtz and Brown, the defensive ends. Hewlett and Happy are the linebackers. The defensive secondary for Rhode Island, Williams and Adams are the corners. Hogan and Granatelli inside. Ball carrier Grooms, and he got just over the 30. Easy to figure out as they had a 1st and 10 from the 20.
Banged up Bobby Donfield on the sideline, wheezing a little bit. Took a hard hit there on a pass he could not come up with. Rhode Island suffering some injuries along the defensive line. Jeff Barlow, you mentioned, and left tackle Greg Benjamin, a freshman who was impressive, is out for the season with a knee injury.
John Carbone is well out of the secondary. 1st and 10, the ball is on the 31-yard line. That's the 2nd first down, I believe, for Richmond this afternoon. Well, okay, he jumps, but then gets back. Off play action. Blyer looks to throw. Football is complete. The tight end, John Henry, a big guy, 6'5", 230-pound senior, out over the 40-yard line to the 44. Jim Happy, the linebacker, covering the tight end, and he made the stop.
Real tough play for any quarterback going to his opposite side. He's rolling to his left, but yet with Blyer's capabilities and the strength that he possesses, he strung it out a little longer, allowing the tight end to get open, Henry, and complete the pass right there. Very strong.
Second first down in the drive, third in the game, first and 10 for the Spiders at the 43. This is an excellent offensive football team. Two receivers, twin receivers set to the bottom of your screen. They give off the left side of the tailback, Grooms. And Grooms gets out close to the 45 live from Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island. Off play action, Blyer to throw, plenty of time. He's got a man, that's the tight end Henry again, who was underneath the coverage. And Henry into Ram territory at the 37-yard line, where Jeff Hogan, the strong safety, just a freshman, that's a young man that will be tested here today, not a lot of game time, a 5'11", 177-pound freshman, so he's giving away 6 inches to the tight end Henry. He hauled him down at the 35, the third first down in the drive for Richmond.
Again, URI has got to put pressure on the quarterback, and if they're going to prevent Blyer from completing those type of passes.
Blyer off a long count to the fullback. Number 44 is Aaron Smith, a big guy at 220 pounds, and three or four blue shirts involved in that hit as he went through the interior of the line. 69, John Gilman. Hard to move him out of the middle at 280 pounds. We'll credit him with the primary stop on the play. As we take a look at the Ram coaching staff on the far side of the field, they've got their work cut out for them here today. An offense that's been averaging 32 points per game, very similar to the one that the Rams had here the past couple of years. Second and 7, football on the 32. To the bottom of your screen, Brian Shields, the flanker. To the top, 82, is James Church. 44, the ball carrier, Smith. Four blue shirts. 73, you saw, was Jim Landry.
And there's a fumble.
Great play defensively along with Mulcahy. A fumble, as you point out, Mel, and the Rams recover. So the first break in the game goes to URI. We'll be back. Excuse me. We'll be back in just a minute.
Tired of eating in the same old places? Come on out to the Queen of Clubs at Lincoln Greyhound Park. Sensational food at a price that makes going out fun again. And just wait till you see the floor show. 12 exciting races with all the action you could ever want. Lincoln Greyhound Park, the
first quarter of today's game being brought to you in part by the Providence Journal Bulletin. Tomorrow's another day. Read all about it. First down play for the Rams. Nets about 5. I did not catch the ball here. Who was it? We take a look.
Well, you see Farland again throws back a very safe pass across the middle to, I believe it's number 81. Steve Schwab, tight end. Pick up a 5 yards, gives a second and 5.
Second and 5. Ball carry off the right side is Poyer, out close to the 40-yard line. They need to get to about the 41 for the first down. Scoreless first quarter. The Richmond drive, which began at their own 20, thwarted as a result of a fumble, recovered nicely there defensively by the leader, the captain today of the defensive corps, Phil Mulcahy. So the Rams own it with a third short yardage situation, third and 1. Third down conversions for the Rams this afternoon. They are 1 for 2. Donfield spreads wide to the bottom of your screen. Pratt at the top. Poyer is the lone running back behind Farland. Poyer, he's got the first down. He's outside the 45, close to midfield. Dragged down by Tony Butler along with Damon Miller. And once again, Poyer continues to impress from the tailback position.
Credit Kiava with a huge block there, springing Poirier.
This is a change of the URI offense. They usually just go with a quick pitch. They pulled the tackle in the guard, got out in front. Poirier, with good speed, was able to make the break to the corner and pick up a good substantial amount of yardage. I'm sorry, he got about 7-8 yards right there for first down, and they're on a drive again.
Ram young ladies seem pretty pleased with the events, at least to this point. We've got 3:53. The Rams have looked good. No! Picked off! Farland has picked off the man with the football, Tony Butler. And once again, adversity strikes the University of Rhode Island as Butler cut in front of the intended receiver, easily picked off the pass and went down the sideline. Nobody within reach. The closest was Farland. He never came close.
The problem with URI is they go to the well once too often. They get a good play, and then they throw the same sideline pattern. And this time it was just picked off clearly. There was no problem at all. He was right in front of me. He took the ball full stride and just skirted down the sideline for a touchdown. A big play for Richmond puts them on the scoreboard. URI's got to tighten their belt a lot more. A lot more action to come in this first half here.
Hard to believe. We've got 3:44 remaining in the first quarter. And to this point, you'd have to say the Rams have had the better of it. Take away that one play. But that one play has resulted in 6 points. The extra point attempt there. The kick is up.
No good. There's a break for Rhode Island. Went wide.
So with 3 minutes, 44 seconds remaining in the first quarter, the teams come back upfield to score. Richmond 6, the University of Rhode Island nothing.
I get a special feeling from my custom van from Courtesy RV Center. Everywhere I go, heads turn.
Meet this year's starting lineup of recreation vehicles from Courtesy, including these champions of the road: Monitor Motorhomes, Fifth Wheels, and Trailers, Micro Minis and Minis by Damon Industries, plus a team of winners from Wilderness and Fan.
Plus, I can fill it with the things I really like.
For the University of Richmond is Tony Butler, a 5'11", 195-pound sophomore. We'll credit him with a 57-yard return of an interception, and as a result, the Spiders lead it 6-0.
Scoreboard shows that it's Richmond 6 and URI nothing. With 3:44 remaining, and Richmond. Okay, you see, Farland just throws the ball, and he just blatantly underthrows it. And Butler just picks off the pass and goes right down the sideline, no problem. Farland in hot pursuit, but unable to catch with the speedy DB.
That pass, I think there in that situation, the coverage was so good it just never should have been released. Nice work by the defender in cutting in front of the intended receiver on the play. Hanna with a shot. Oh, wow, poor kick. Fair catch, fumble, loose football. Spiders own it. Poor kick by Hanna, and the Spiders get another break. Up off the bottom of the pile for Richmond, number 47, John Coleman, I believe, is the man to fall on the football. Let's take a look.
You can't even explain what happens with the URI Rams right now. A simple kick that doesn't even go 15 yards. One of the up men elects to receive it, goes through his hands because he's not used to catching it, and Richmond recovers the ball again. Tough break for the Rams.
Would have been excellent field position for the Rams outside their own 40. Instead, great field position for the Spiders operating from the Rams 42. The pass from Blyer complete. The receiver on the far side, Brian Shields, a 6'175-pound senior, the leading receiver on the club.
I hate to say a team is snake that way. It just seems that way, doesn't it? That was probably the worst kick in football history. And they would have had great field position, and yet it's a fumble. It's just hard to explain. Once a team gets in a pattern of losing, it just seems to stay with them.
Second and four from the 36. Rams do not need to go down two touchdowns. Give up the right side. Big hole. Outside operating. Irwin Matthews dragged down at the 20-yard line. Paul Granatelli finally got him, but a gaping hole off the right side. And Matthews, who can scoot, he had a 65-yard scamper 1 week ago, moves the ball deep into Ram territory at the 20.
But when Grooms graduates, Matthews is going to take his place quite easily. The sophomore, a little quick handoff here. Blyer dropping back. And Matthews does it all himself. He's got good downfield blocking, and he's just a quick little whirling dervish type of back. Makes some nice moves and gains some substantial yardage.
Twin receivers set to the top of the screen, off the right side. The give once again to Matthews. This time the Rams smell it out. Nice work defensively there as motion went to the far side of the field. Brown and Happy combining on the stop defensively for the Rams, so a pickup of about a yard. Second and nine from the 19. We have 2:16 remaining in a first quarter. The Spiders, as a result of a 57-yard interception return, lead it by 6. Rams have done a nice job defending against the rush for the most part, with the exception of that one run by Matthews. They had held Grooms to 19 yards on 6 attempts, replaced now by Matthews. A play action, Blyer to throw, receiver at the goal line. Nice work defensively there by Anthony Adams. That pass was right on the money. The intended receiver was Shields. However, nice work defensively, and the pass falls incomplete.
If you're looking at the Richmond sideline right now, they're calling for some sort of penalty there.
Blyer just sets up, throws a nice pass. He saw the receiver downfield, all the way. He's picked him out, and it looked as though he may have been interfered with a little prematurely. I thought he was pushed because when the ball was coming at him, he seemed to have lurched forward. Referee didn't catch it, or maybe I just viewed it incorrectly. Nonetheless, Richmond has the ball. It was a good defensive play right there by URI.
Third and nine from the 19-yard line. Critical third down conversion call. Blyer with time. Too much time. Pass is picked off. Four blue shirts in the area of the intended receiver, the tight end John Henry, and Paul Granatelli, a 5'11", 188-pound sophomore out of Franklin Lakes, New Jersey, comes up with the interception.
That's a nice feeling for a sophomore to get on the team. It seems as though Blyer had a lot of time, dropped way back, dropped about 10 yards deep just to view the field, but then he just flipped the ball with his wrist. He didn't really step forward, threw it into a crowd of people. Granatelli picks off the ball, and he safely is tackled without losing the ball. Good break, but they're in deep inside the territory. Let's see if URI can punch it out of there.
From their own 7-yard line, first and 10 with a minute 40 remaining in the first quarter. So they needed to thwart that effort, and they did. Going deep. Donfield, however, he did not outrace the secondary. To this point in the game, Jordan has stayed with Donfield pretty much step for step.
Well, when you know that they're going to be passing, your defensive backs are going to be a little bit more lenient, and they're going to give you that 5-yard out pattern. And
well, they didn't a couple of minutes ago, though, I'll tell you that.
he certainly didn't. Butler just jumped in front, and there's an anguished Bob Griffin, excuse me, thank you.
Standing next to him, Paul Galani, who is the backup quarterback. Farland faced with a second and 10. Minute 35, first quarter. Rams trailing by 6. To the far side, overthrown. Farland had a receiver that time, and it would have been, if he would have hauled it down, a first down. The intended receiver on the far side of the field was number 24, Jimmy Pratt. The pass, however, off mark, and as a result, it will be a third and 10. Interesting statistic, I'll mention this to my teammates in the broadcast booth. In the first quarter, URI with 9 first downs, Richmond with 6. So it has been offensively a good quarter for the Rams. They've done everything once again, as the coach mentioned in the pregame, but put points on the board.
Farland getting good protection today as well. 30 sacks in 6 games, an awful lot.
Single running back is Poyer. Third down conversion call for the Rams here. Farland's got time, and he has a receiver, and once again, just overthrown. The intended receiver is Bobby Donfield. Once again, it is Jordan along with Mark Auker. And that time, it appeared that Donfield did have a step on the defender, but the pass was high, and as a result, the Rams will be forced to punt.
It's just a good, strong pass upfield, and he's overthrown by Farland. Unfortunately, when you don't connect on a few occasions, the ball just tends to get more and more errant and farther away.
Tom Centauri to punt. On the far side of the field, Jordan back. However, it takes a Ram bounce, finally down at the 45-yard line, so a good kick considering. Tommy Centauri came in averaging 32 yards a punt. He's a 5'11", 190-pound junior out of Johnston. The score is 6-0. We're back in a minute. First down for the Spiders. Grooms is the ball carry. The line of scrimmage was the 46. Jim Landry stopped him after a gain of about a yard. Landry along with Mulcahy credited with the stop on the play. It'll be 2nd and 9. So once again, the Rams are doing a nice job defensively. The 6 points that Richmond has tallied has come as a result of a miscue, a mistake, a big one, by quarterback Greg Farland. Rams to this point playing inspired football, Rich.
Fortunately, they didn't let that other mistake on that terrible kick and then the fumble. They held Richmond at bay, and it's still only 6-0, plenty of time.
Ball carrier Grooms with some room to run as he looks to turn the corner, head down, and once again, nice pursuit. It looked like that play might develop, but some great work defensively as they strung him out. Jim Happy over number 38. Stopping the ball carrier Grooms. As we mentioned the last time we checked it, Grooms had been averaging about 3 yards a carry this afternoon, came in averaging about 5.
Again, they like to go to the opposite side, swing left, and hand the ball inside. Grooms with good speed, unable to get to the corner, but yet makes a gallant effort to get at least 3 yards, and here we are, 3rd down and 7.
This is the 4th third down conversion opportunity for the Spiders. They have yet to convert. We've got a whistle, and perhaps No, it's not a delay of game. We have completed one quarter of play here at Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island, where at the end of 15 minutes, it is Richmond 6 and Rhode Island nothing. At the Ram, 42 just underway, second quarter off play action, Blyer to throw. Overthrown, intended receivers crossing on the play. Number 20 is Brian Shields, number 82 James Church, and they brought with them just about the entire defensive secondary for the Rams. So the fourth third down conversion opportunity for the Spiders, and they come up shy.
We said the URI defense has played well, and they're showing it right now. Good passing, pass rush by Ken Kurtz there as well, putting some pressure on Blyer, and they were well covered in the secondary.
Man to kick it is Olivo, the kick coming from the 47-yard line. Big kick into the Ram end zone. Did he get off a big one?
Punt was a little better than that kickoff.
From the line of scrimmage, he is credited with a 42-yard kick, but in the air, that thing went 60 yards.
Beautiful kick. And that's why he leads the Yankee Conference, and he may have himself a future as a punter somewhere.
Second quarter of today's game is being brought to you in part by Miller, Made the American Way. Greg Farland takes his offensive unit up to the line of scrimmage. First and 10, they own the football for the first time in the second quarter from their own 20-yard line. The running back remains Poyer, subbing for the injured Doug Haynes. Pass complete to the far side of the field. That's to Donfield, out close to the 30-yard line. Brian Jordan, the man to run him out of bounds. And remember, we had said that Farland had been struggling. He has completed unofficially. We have him for only 5 of 13. Despite that fact, the Rams have amassed 10 first downs.
Again, URI went to that same pass pattern, a quick out by Donfield. Completed it this time, but last time it was picked off for a touchdown. So let's see if URI can diversify a little bit and ignite some offensive spark.
Credit him with a pickup of about, now they say 7, so we'll call it a 2nd and 3. All kinds of movement at the line of scrimmage, and we see 3 yellow flags.
Looks like it's going to be against URI.
Left side of the offensive line, I thought, jumped early, and that drew the defense off. On the left side for the University of Rhode Island, you can take a look there, number 77 and 71. Cuyava's number 71 and number 77 for the University of Rhode Island. We're going to have to check the chart here because he is not listed on the 2 deep. 77 is Levy.
Andy Levy changed his number, I guess. We have him listed here at 75.
2nd and 8 now as a result of the 5-yard walk-off. He throws long and deep, and once again, they go for Donfield, and the man on him defensively, they keep trying to burn Brian Jordan, and Jordan's having none of it as he keeps with the receiver step for step.
Bobby's not at 100%. It's going to be tough for him to burn a speedy guy like Brian Jordan, even if he's at full speed.
He's not their burner at any rate because the fastest guy in the team has been pointed out to us this year, Jimmy Pratt.
Right, 4.5, 4.6 speed, real blazer.
Jordan's smart enough to use the sideline as an extra defender so that Donfield has to be run out of bounds and can't make the completion anyway.
Third down conversion opportunity for the Rams from their own 23-yard line. 14:40 in the half. Spiders lead it by 6. Farland with time. Almost picked off. The intended receiver was Schwab, the tight end Steve Schwab, and Troy Gray dropping back from his linebacker position. Got a hand on it. It shows you the finite situation when you throw the football.
Well, you see, it seems as though Farland just threw the ball, and he's not throwing the ball with the tenacity that a quarterback in his position should. He should throw the ball a lot harder. He seemed to be throwing off his back foot, and it just tailed off in the wind. Almost as though he thinks, I don't think I can complete this pass.
Centauri. The reception by Jordan, who is immediately run down from the 45. He gets it out to about midfield.
Getting back to that play, Mal, if that pass was to be completed, you would have to zip it in there. There's no other way.
Well, there were so many defenders in between, and it is a 35-yard pass. He's trying to float the ball up in there, and again, he's throwing off his back foot, just muscling it with his arm. He's not the strongest guy in the world, and I can't understand why he's throwing to the middle of the field. You've got to use a little bit more diversity. You know they're going to be there, and he still throws it anyway.
First and 10 for Richmond, operating from their own 49. A 32-yard punt for Centauri, not an exceptionally good one. Receiver on the far side of the field, or the near side, rather, is Brian Shields. And Shields, within a step of getting by the secondary, as he hauls it in, a pickup of about 7 on the play. We'll call it 2nd and 3. He very nearly got by the defense.
Here's a stat for you now. URI has stayed close with the opposition in the first quarter, 21-17 now, with 6 points today, 27-17. But in the second quarter, they've been outscored 60-10. That just about tells it all, doesn't it?
Football in Ram territory at the 43-yard line. It's 2nd and 3 for Richmond. Flyer to the tailback, Matthews. Nice work defensively by Damon Hewlett as he drilled him right at the line of scrimmage. 6'3", 220-pound senior from West Islip, New York.
Third on the team in tackles this season, 2nd last year. Lost his tag team partner back there, Pat Lawson. They were dynamite a year ago.
Richmond faced before them their 5th third down conversion opportunity of the afternoon. They have yet to convert. They're in a good position to do so here, though, as they are faced with 3rd and a little bit less than a yard as the football rests. The Ram 41, the pitch back to Matthews. He's got enough of a hole inside the 40 to the 38. John Gilman slides over from his nose tackle position to stop the tailback.
That's what you can do when you have a diversified offense. I think that's Muse and Donfield discussing things on the sideline. I think they want to be able to say, let's get a couple of completions, let's get a score in the end zone, let's make it happen. But back to what I was saying before this ensuing of this next play, with a running attack such as Richmond has, they can do a lot of things with it. They went with a wide sweep, the back cut inside, and got the first down.
First and 10 from the 38-yard line. The tailback remains Matthews. The fullback, Morgan, movement off the left side. It appeared it was number 74, Howard Fonstock, the offensive left tackle. Referee working
yes.
this game today, Joel right, Golden.
Right.
And we will await the indication as you take a look at Bobby Blyer. What a quarterback. Career coming in, 583 for 1,002 yards, or 6,966 yards, I'm sorry, 58% completion record and 50 touchdowns.
That's in the same class as a Tom Earhart.
5-yard walk-off. It's a 1st and 15 as the football moves back now to the 43-yard line of URI. 82 to the top of the screen is Church. He's looking in that direction. The pass is complete as Blyer throws a strike. And as you were commenting moments ago with regard to Farland, Blyer really drilled that pass right into the belly of the receiver on the play.
Well, it's the experience he has as well. He's been a varsity quarterback for a while. Farland's been an understudy.
Well, there's also a difference in the caliber of ball that's being played between URI and Richmond. When you play out in different territories, you'll find that the game's a little bit more open and the passing attack is a little bit more precise. URI on the East tends to be a more running-dominated offense, except for, again, with URI passing.
Off the left side, Irwin Matthews. Damon Hewlett from his linebacker position along with 87. You've seen a lot of him already today. The defensive tackle for the Rams, Phil Mulcahy. Pickup of 4. It'll be a 3rd and 4 now with the football on the Ram 32. We have 11:28 remaining in the second quarter. Rams trying to keep the Wolves, or more appropriately, the Spiders, off their door at this point as they trail already by 6. Flyer to throw. Good pressure. Kenny Kurtz, 5'11", 217-pound junior out of Holmes, New York. That's exactly what the Rams needed. They've got to put pressure on Blyer. On that occasion, they did.
Well, here they came with an all-out blitz. You saw everybody just coming from the outside. I was very surprised that Blyer wasn't able to see it. You see him coming right up. He stood in the pocket strong. Good defensive effort. Good strong surge by the defensive front line. Allowed them to put Richmond in a punting situation.
2nd sack of the season for number 37, Kenny Kurtz.
Leave it a punt once again from his own 47, and once again he sails it all the way through the end zone.
He's upset with himself, wanted to hang it perhaps and get a coffin corner or something. Ray Guy, out there. He's a great punter.
10:33 remaining. 6-0 to score. Back in a minute. Rams on it. First and 10 from their 20-yard line. Farland with good time. Great work by the offensive line. He's still looking. He's finally got a receiver. Poyer downfield. I saw Pratt, who looked like he was open to the near sideline. The pass reception, however, by Poyer. Stopped by Pat Brown. Short yardage pickup on the play to the 24. We'll call it 2nd and 6.
Give a lot of credit to the URI offensive line. Did a dynamite job in protecting Farland today. As I mentioned, he's been sacked 30 times this season, which is an awful lot. They're giving him plenty of time today, so we'll have to focus a lot of the blame if Rhode Island can't score on him at this point.
Pratt to the near side, Donfield to the far side. This time we take a look at number 26 for the University of Rhode Island, Dave Morrill. First time we've seen him out there today. Delay a game. Ouch, 5-yard walk off, and we'll be right back. 20, head down to the 25, outside of the 27. A flag is down, and I believe we have a face mask.
Yeah, big break for URI right now. If that is a face mask, we'll have to see.
We'll see what that flag is all about.
Yep, looks like you're right, Mike. Very observant this afternoon, I must say.
Personal foul, face mask
yes.
Violation against the Spiders is the call.
URI will take anything at this point. Tack on some extra yardage on this drive. Move the ball awfully well. Farland, as I mentioned, has had good protection to throw the football.
There are two types of face mask infractions. One is an inadvertent face mask, which is a 5-yard walk-off. This one, they feel, was much more flagrant, so they walk off 15. The Rams have a first down outside their 40 at their own 42.
Richmond's a highly penalized team. They generally were penalized 247 yards, I believe, in penalties, which is 63 yards per game they've been penalized. So that's a big, significant category not to be on the top of.
First and 10 from their own 42 off the left side. The ball carrier, Morrill, I believe, out close to the 45-yard line. Stop made that time by Rafe Wilkinson.
Morrill was the number one back last season in the early portion of the year. Started 8 games, 97 yards, and 27 carries. Only carried the ball twice coming into the game today. It's just 3 yards. Haynes, of course, has taken over the starting position. And it looks like Doug is in the game right now. For the
he
first
may have been
today.
The ball carrier. That's yeah. 25. Morrill is 26.
Maybe
I believe
right.
We're looking at Haynes.
Okay.
Short pickup. They credit him with 2. We'll call it now 2nd and 8. Once again, the Rams giving him lots of time. Use the tight end, puts his head down, close to the first down. Excellent play by Jimmy Mules, 6'3", 203-pound junior. Troy Gray on the stop defensively, but there you see a tight end working at his best. Lots of labor after the catch.
Looked like Brian Foster a little bit there. Jimmy has 16 receptions on the season, 156 yards, had a big day last week along with his tight end partner Steve Schwab.
They mark it just shy of the first down, so we'll call it 3rd down and less than a yard. Football just inside Richmond territory, just shy of the 49-yard line. The running back remains Doug Haynes. Haynes has the football, loses it. Haynes never had control of the football, lost it. As you can see, 2-3 white shirts taking advantage of yet another opportunity. Up off the bottom of the pile, number 94 for Richmond is Brian Tuff.
You see Farland just pitched the ball out here, and Haynes doesn't even have a chance to get his balance. Perhaps his groin is bothering him, so he couldn't pick his leg up and get it on the grass fast enough, but the ball was just out of his hands. First primary concern of a running back is to hold on that ball, because if you don't, That's going to be the end result.
Have a player down, and Mal, excuse me, really can't see the number at this vantage point.
Now, let me ask you a question. The obvious problem that he had was in tucking in the football. It looked like he was trying to take that big first step at the same time he tried to tuck it in, stumbled a bit, and lost it. What's the priority in that situation?
Well, the first thing to do is to get your hand down the ball. You cannot get to the hole. You cannot make the corner. But if you have the ball in your hand, you can always go back to the huddle and regroup. If you lose the ball, there's no excuse for it, and that's one of the problems that you have. I'm very surprised that they pitched out to Haynes there when he didn't have much previous playing.
Brian Jordan, who's played tremendously so far in the first half, seems
to
be
okay.
You
don't like to see anybody hurt, but certainly Bobby Donfield would breathe a sigh of relief. Richmond very nearly came up with the big play that Bob Griffin had alluded to. You need big plays in football games. That time, Blyer to Henry, and he very nearly came up with a miraculous grab.
Surprisingly, he threw this ball. There were three defenders right there. You had Williams there, you had Adams there, and John Henry, because of his superior size, I guess the Blyer just wanted to go to him anyway. He made a great effort, and then you saw some flying people going around for that ball. Nonetheless, it's an incomplete pass, and Richmond has the ball again.
Rams really being tested here defensively, spending too much time on the field as a result of some offensive miscues. Once again, it's Fonstock. That's the second time he's jumped off the line, and I'm sure that the offensive line coach is going to have a word with him. That's just concentration.
Well, you see Hewlett and Happy were really excited about that. Apparently they're getting fired up inside, and they're making things happen, and that's what URI has to do. The defense has been out there an inordinate amount of time. They must be getting tired, and they're playing basically on just emotional desire and nothing else right now.
That's been their problem all season, too. They've been on the field so often.
Second and 15, football at midfield. We have 7:27 remaining in the half. Richmond leads it by 6. Margin of difference, a 57-yard interception return. Blyer to run. Inside the 40-yard line, so he picks up about 11 on the play of the 15 that he needed. Nice work by Blyer. The receivers were covered. He was able to get outside the containment.
That's what a veteran will do. He won't force the pass. He saw he had a lot of field to run with, and he just tucked it in. Rhode Island, 3 turnovers this afternoon, brings their total up to 28, 18 interceptions, and 10 fumbles.
This is the 7th third down conversion opportunity for Richmond, and the credit to the Ram defense, Blyer has yet to convert. Over the middle, he does that time. The tight end has it inside the 25-yard line. Aaron Smith defending, John Henry, and he's a good one, 6'5", 230-pound senior, came into the game with 35 receptions for 415 yards, and he certainly has been a thorn in the Rams' side.
Carlin just throwing, Blyer throwing off his back foot, still has the strength to muscle it into John Henry, who breaks a couple of tackles and lunges forward for some extra yardage. Big, strong player. Nice person to have at a tight end position.
First and 10 at the Ram 22. Rams desperately trying to avert seeing another 6 points go up on the board. Blyer off play action. Intended receiver on the near side was Jim Church. Defending on the play was number 27, Paul Granatelli, along with 22, Jeff Hogan. The two safeties combining to work defensively against the wide receiver for Richmond. Bobby Blyer will bring his offensive unit back to huddle at about the 30-yard line. Football at the Ram 22, second and 10.
Boy, they like using that play action an awful lot, and it's working too. They're really freezing everybody back there.
Well, when you have the quality athletes behind you, you can do almost anything you want. If you give the running backs the ball and they gain yardage, what are you going to do? If you're going to throw the pass to a receiver, and they're going to catch it. So you don't know how to defend against them, so one is a combination of both.
Grooms is the ball carrier. Credit on the stop defensively to Jim Lander. You heard the public address announcer blare it out as well, along with Damon Hewlett, the linebacker. We will credit him with a pickup on the play of about 3. We'll call it third and 7. I'm sorry. Football at the 18-yard line. Third down conversion. Once again, outside containment is Blyer. Pass is complete. Blyer was able to get outside Kenny Kurtz. The pass was completed. Aaron Smith defending on the play. And the reception by...
Looks like Henry again, if I'm not mistaken.
The stop was by Smith.
I thought it might have been Church, but we'll take a look. 80, the man on the reception, and 80 for Richmond is Lance Sheely, who is an alternate flanker. Sheely, the man to come up with the football. Measurement now as the official, the referee working this contest today, Joe Goldman, calls for the sticks.
This reminder, ladies and gentlemen, that next Tuesday,
Richmond obviously in four down territory. Should they come up high, shy, it will be an interesting decision whether they go for the field goal or the first. They are shy by, as you can see the indication, by one of the interior linemen by a couple of feet.
You'll see that Richmond, who's normally the past few weeks been a high-powered offense, they may have been thinking URI lost to BU, we beat BU 56 to whatever we beat them by, we may come in a little bit lax. They don't seem to be showing the high-powered offense that they had previously. We haven't had the opportunity to see them, and there's the Ram mascot dancing with a little kid in the stands, having a little fun on a wonderful, beautiful autumn afternoon.
Fourth and one. Flyer behind center Chris Tate. Off the right side, that's Bell and Fonstock, the right guard and right tackle. Mulcahy involved in the stop defensively, number 87. Take another look.
Simple quarterback sneak. Now you've got Blyer, who's 6'2 himself, 6'3. Big, strong kid. Just a simple surge up the middle. URI playing off the ball a little bit. Very difficult play to stop. You wonder that why they don't use that more often on a short and... third and or fourth and one, but they don't. Sometimes it gets stopped.
Football outside the 10-yard line, so it is possible for Blyer and the Spiders to pick up a first down without getting into the end zone. Now they're first and 10, football at the 11-yard line. We've got 5:35 remaining in the half. The fullback with the football, nice second effort there by Aaron Smith, and he's a battering ram at 220 pounds. Jim Happy finally drags him down at about the 8-yard line. That was a hard three.
It's a gain of three, second down and seven.
No, I think you're right about the Richmond offense. Question of maybe them coming in a little lax, but let's give some credit to the URI defense playing inspired football at this point with almost 5 minutes to go in the second quarter of play.
They have played really a good football game to this point. Flyer. Pass is wobbly and short. Yeah. We're going to have a flag. No need for the pass interference. Once again, a mistake. I'm not sure that the defensive back on that side didn't trip on the play. He just stumbled into the receiver, defending on the play, Aaron Smith, and it looked like he just stumbled into the intended receiver, and as a result, the Spiders will get a first down.
You see Blyer throwing a wobbly pass to the corner of the end zone. He had to throw it about 25, 30 yards, but you see the referee behind him throwing the flag because he just happened to come over the top. You can't do that. You've got to give the receiver the opportunity to catch the ball freely without any interference.
So instead of an incompleted pass, because the pass was a poor one, which would have resulted in a third and seven from the Ram 8-yard line, it will now be first and goal for the Spiders from the URI 2.
I guess they put that on the 2-yard line because the pass was in the end zone, because normally it's at the point of contact for a pass interference, but I guess at that play he was in the end zone and they bring it out to the 2.5 or the 2-yard line where field goals are generally marked off to be kicked.
The point we're talking about is that these things seem to keep happening to Rhode Island. It's hard to explain. The defense is playing awfully well. You have good coverage right there by Aaron Smith on the intended receiver and he just loses his footing and falls into him. It's something that doesn't happen to teams who are winning. When you're losing, whether it's you're trying hard or not really isn't often a question. It's just that your mistakes keep compounding themselves, and that's what's happening to a team that is 0-6 right now. You set a pattern for losing, and that's what's happening.
That's it in a nutshell.
And the people in attendance right now showing it on their faces. Rhode Island playing Richmond pretty much head up in this first half of play, 4:55 to go. Richmond, a team that scored 56 points against Boston University. They scored over 40 against VMI last week, and they've only scored 6 in this game. The offense has not been that impressive.
Statistically, the Spiders with 13 first downs, the 13th one, a critical one, picked up as a result of a penalty. The Rams with 11, they have moved the football, but once again, as Bob Griffin pointed out in our conversation prior to the game, their problem has not been moving the football, it's been getting points on the board. That's exactly the situation. They trail by 6. We have just under 5 minutes to play, and they are in certainly dread of going down by 12 or 13 points to a club that, although they are 3-3, certainly are a better club than their record indicates.
Could easily be 6-0. Three tough Yankee Conference losses, two of them on the road.
Well, they started off that way last year. They ended up winning their last five games in a row, and they were able to get into the NCAA playoffs. So don't count Richmond out yet. They're 3-3 right now, but they're on an upswing, and they're playing the University of Rhode Island, and they lead right now 6-0, and they seem to be on a scoring drive right now.
Their problem with regard to the conference, however, is going to be the fact that they not only have to catch one club, they have to catch two. They've got to catch both Delaware and New Hampshire. You can hope that somebody's going to knock off one club, but I doubt that they can expect that both Delaware and New Hampshire are going to suffer two more defeats apiece.
Well, Maine is also 5-2, too, Mike, so there's another team that they have to contend with.
Here we go, set to resume action now. First and goal from the two. Blyer's got Grooms at the tailback, Smith at the fullback. Grooms leaps.
His father lost everything.
Looked like a high jumper, and we got no indication of a touchdown, so he comes up shy. Aaron Smith was the man to put the shoulder to him to stop him from breaking the plane to the goal line.
Excellent offensive surge and a great leap by Grooms there. He got off the ground about 6 feet. He was above the defensive lineman. He jumps up in the air. His momentum carries him. A good, strong hit by Williams. And
second and goal. Loose football. Rams indicate they own it.
A little premature, I guess, Mike.
Grooms is down. That'd be a big, big loss. We'll be back in just a moment.
Welcome back to Meade Stadium in Kingston. Here is the play that has left Grooms injured on the sideline.
Okay, Blyer was giving the ball to him, and just as he was trying to propel himself upward, someone caught him in the knee as he began to switch. Ken Kurtz got underneath him, twisted his knee severely. It could be a knee or an ankle, but whatever it is, it's
Grooms is
him.
Out. Matthews is in. Third and goal from the one. Blyer's going to throw. He's got a man. Touchdown. Matthews, and the man he beat was Kenny Kurtz, as Kurtz got his feet tangled as he tried to reverse himself to chase Matthews on the play. So Blyer, hard to believe, third and short yardage from the goal. That tells you something. When they elect not to go to the running game, unfortunately, they're able to pick up 6.
Well, when you've got something that works very well, you've got a quarterback that can throw the ball simply through, led the tailback out into the open behind Kurtz, who stopped Grooms on the previous play, put him out, and then you have the speedster and Williams making the touchdown.
They go for the two-point conversion. Remember, the extra point attempt, the first touchdown was shy. This time they get it. The conversion that time, the completion from Blyer, he throws the strike to Jim Church. As a result, as the teams come back up the field with just 3 minutes, 43 seconds remaining in the first half, it is the University of Richmond 14 and Rhode Island nothing. Welcome back to Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island, as you take a look at Ned Arnold, who is their place kicker, about to kick off. The Rams now trailing 14-0 with just under 4 minutes remaining in the half. To the near side, and that is Pratt. At the 25. Outside the 30, drilled from behind, put down hard at the 33-yard line for Richmond. Ryan Shields, the man who climbed his back and put him down. So the Rams take over, desperately needing to get some offense going. As you take a look at the Richmond bench, they still believe they've got some work cut out for them. In fact, the truth is the Rams have played well despite trailing by 2 scores.
While we're looking at the Richmond bench, Grooms being taped on the sideline. Looks like he maybe sprained, twisted his ankle. See if he comes back in there.
Greg Farland He's got Chris Poyer in the backfield, number 21. Poyer owns the football. Outside the 35, and the football squirts loose, but it was well after his knee touched. John Coleman, along with number 17, Damon Miller, combining on the hit defensively for the Spiders. It will be for the Rams a second and seven. We'll call it a pickup of three.
Never-ending story. URI plays well and have absolutely nothing to show for it.
Second and seven. Nice effort again by Poyer as he gets out close to the 40-yard line. And I would think at this point the defense for Richmond has got to be pleased to be giving up real estate in 3 and 4 yards because the clock is going to favor them. It is moving now with 2:40 remaining in the half. 81 in your screen is Muse, the tight end. They work with two. The one on the far side, number 41, is Muse, and to the near side, 81 is Schwab. Nice move. The same fake. Farland out of bounds in Richmond territory at the 47-yard line. So that time, they gave the same look, and the defense was fooled. They went for Poyer, and Farland bootlegged it into Richmond territory for the first down.
URI has to do an awful lot more of that in the remaining games that they have. They're 0-6 right now. They've got to generate some type of offensive spark, whether they run double reverses, single reverses, any type of trick plays, just to get people off the fact that they are a very consistent team and doing the same things over and over again.
Let's Rams now 3 of 7 in third down conversions. First and 10 football at the Richmond 48. Poyer cuts inside, still on his feet, inside the 45 to the 42-yard line. Nice work offensively by the blocking wall for the University of Rhode Island. Brian, too, defensively for the Spiders. And once again, you have to credit the offensive line for the Rams. They are moving them out.
There's a gain of 6 on the play. Second down and 4.
Second and 4 from the 43-yard line. .146. Clock is moving. Poyer, the lone running back. Farland high and well overthrown. And once again, that same situation with Brian Jordan all over the back of Bobby Donfield. That time Farland saw it and just threw it out of bounds.
It's the same pass pattern they've been running throughout the game. Obviously, Richmond very accustomed to this at this point.
I would think the way they've been running the ball up the middle, it might be a good opportunity to go over the middle to one of the tight end Schwab or Muse.
Obviously, the Rhode Island coaching staff sees it a little differently, and that's why they are where they are, and that's why we are where we are.
Donfield and Pratt are the wide receivers. Poyer, the single running back. Third down conversion call, it's 3rd and 4. Nice catch. Excellent catch by Schwab. Number 97, Pat Brown, the linebacker, got a hand on it. It bounded into the air. Schwab, with excellent concentration, hauled it down.
Exactly, Mike. That's great concentration, keeping your eye on the football, tipped and still able to make the reception. That's just a tremendous play.
University of Rhode Island now 4 of 8 in third down conversions. Richmond, by comparison, 3 of 9.
Okay. You see, Farland throws the ball with a little bit more authority on this play. Is able to get it out of the hands of Pat Brown and into the hands of Steve Schwab after he bounced it off his hands. Now, that's one of the things that receivers do all the time. They have bad ball drills and they have tip drills. The defensive backs do the same thing. If ball gets tipped, you have to respond to it, you have to react to it. Good catch, first down, enough on the second effort. There's the rewards that some of the URI athletes have to have.
14th first down in the contest for the University of Rhode Island. Clock is moving now as the official, the referee, Goldman, has wound the clock. It is under 120. First and 10 for the Rams. They own the football at the Richmond 38-yard line. This is the best drive they've had since the opening drive, which resulted in the missed 34-yard field goal. Farland's got a receiver. Great catch. Pass was high, but Muse held it onto it. Out of bounds at the 30-yard line, shy of the first down by a couple, but the clock has stopped with exactly 1 minute remaining in the half.
Now, Mike, you said that they usually have 14 first downs right now. They average 16.2 first downs a game. This is only a half, and they've got more, almost equaling their game first down total. So let's see if they can put some scores on the board here and get them some respectability.
Second and two, football at the 30. Pratt and downfield are the wide receivers. Barley looking, he's got a man tipped up, used the intended receiver, Mark Hawker. And once again, the defenders for Richmond are matching the Ram receivers stride for stride. It looked as though momentarily Muse had a step. The pass was pretty much on the money, but you could see it was tipped away.
Farland again gets to the outside. He didn't elect to run this time, throws the ball instead. Hawker seems to be in his face, gets his left hand up, taps the ball. That could have been the key that prevented the referee from throwing the flag, because he did seem to be interfering, but he went for the ball and got his hand on it.
54 seconds. That play took 6 seconds. It's third and two now. Football at the 30. They are definitely in four down territory, so they'll get two more cracks at the 2 yards. Hoyer. I believe he got the first down. He was knocked out of bounds. I believe the clock did stop. No, it did not.
They strung that play outside. If he had stuck with his initial decision to go inside, he could have muscled it away.
Clock is stopped with 49 seconds remaining. Let's see where they mark it. On the far side of the field, it is very close to the 28-yard line. That's about where...
Fourth down is signaled right now.
I believe they're going to call for a measurement, and if they don't, I would be surprised if Farland and the Brown or the, Ram coaching staff asked for the indication.
I think he's going to be like a smidgen short.
Okay, they will look for the first down. We'll be back in just a minute. Welcome back. The measurement, you can see the indication. Well, you see now the legs as you draw. The picture is drawn out. They missed the first down by about a foot and a half. So they're faced now with a fourth and half a yard. You can give it to me metrically if you like. Anyway, they've got to pick it up. 49 seconds remaining. They trail by 14.
Oh.
I believe he got it. Hoyer did get the first down, but then he was really set back hard. Troy Gray, we believe, is the man who put a shoulder to him. Gray, number 65, an inside linebacker at 220 pounds. Hoyer at 186, and he felt, I'm sure, all of it.
You only need a foot and a half, and that's an awful tough foot and a half. He gets knocked backwards 3.5 yards, but he got the first down just by his forward momentum, just like breaking the plane on the end line. All you got to do is get that distance, let the referee mark it, and you get the first down.
Gray definitely gave him a chest pain, though. There's no doubt about that.
What a wave, and they're going to measure again because they're not sure, but I think he got it, and if they didn't, it was a poor judgment call by the referee, but they did get it right there.
All right.
Picked it up by about the length of the football, the 15th first down for the University of Rhode Island here at the half, and yet they do not have any points on the board. We have 45 seconds remaining. The Rams own it first and 10 in Spider territory at the 27, trailing 14 to nothing. Mike Lyons with Rich D. Simone and Mal Najarian live from Meade Stadium in Kingston. It's been a good one. Overthrown. He had a receiver near the first down, Jimmy Pratt, and the pass was high. You got to know the frustration that has to be in the hearts and person of the 75-plus blue shirts and coaching staff on the far side of the field, because this is the way the season has gone, and we grimace and groan up here, so you can imagine what they're doing on the sideline. They deal with this 7 days a week. Second and 10. 30 seconds now on the scoreboard clock. On the blitz, blocker picked it up. Great reception by number 81, Steve Schwab. And a remarkable effort, 21, Chris Poyer, awful slow to get up.
Picked
he
up the blitz
there.
He may
have been the young man to pick up
right.
the blitz, and that
exactly.
made the play.
Made the play, you're right, Mike. Great reception as well. Poyer really giving up his body on that play. Timeout by Rhode Island, 23 seconds left. They have to put some points on the board here.
You'll see that Poyer picked up the blitz by number 17, Damon Miller, cut him down, giving Farland the extra time to find a receiver. excellent pinpoint pass to Steve Schwab, who again, with incredible concentration, was able to wrestle the ball away from number 40, Mark Auger. And it's now first down inside the five. We're going for a break, and we'll be back.
Contest for the Rams, certainly their biggest of the afternoon. The reception by Schwab on the pass from Farland. Credit Chris Poyer with a magnificent block to allow Farland the time. First and goal for the Rams. They trail by 14, 23 seconds remaining in the first half. The running back, Doug Haynes, as Poyer was limping moments ago. Haynes to about the two, and the Rams will call a timeout. 18 seconds remaining, second and goal.
The enthusiasm here is shown almost as though it's being a championship game right now. The fans are all excited. We're excited in the booth here. We would like to see URI score. After all, we are partial to them because we're from the area, but let's see what they can do here. They're in four down territory inside the five. Let's see them put a score in for the Ram faithful out there.
Interesting call because, of course, with 26 seconds on the clock, you can definitely throw the football four times for the score. If you run it, you're not going to get four opportunities. So it'll be interesting to see the play selection now for the University of Rhode Island, now faced with a second and goal, the football on the two-yard line.
But they still have two timeouts left, Mike, so they can do anything that they so desire, whatever works most effectively to get the ball in the end zone.
Let's see the choice. Pratt to the near side, Donfield to the far side, Haynes the single running back behind Greg Farland. Farland rolls. The pass is high and overthrown. Once again, the pass is overthrown. The intended receiver on the near side, Jimmy Pratt, third and goal. Clock shows 14 seconds remaining in the first half.
That's one of the toughest things in the world. You'll see Farland rolling to his right out here, and he's not sure of himself, so he's throwing the ball off balance. He fires it. He throws it with a pretty decent velocity, but it's so tough on a play like that, unless the guy's wide open. You got to lob that ball in there a little bit. It's like a halfback option, real tough. Here we come for the third down and goal. And Mike, tell us what we're going to do.
14 seconds remaining. Haynes, the running back. Good pressure. The pass is high and picked off. Great pressure applied there by number 31, Kim Pettis, and number 38 for Richmond was Errol Robertson. They did not give Farland enough time as he looked to the short side of the field, and he elected to try and force the ball in. It did not work. It was picked off by the man, Brian Jordan, that we saw all afternoon putting great coverage on Donfield. Take another look.
You'll see Farland just threw the ball backpedaling. I can't understand why he did that. There was somebody in his face. Just hum the ball out of bounds. Get it out of there. Get yourself another chance to either get a touchdown or a field goal. Now they've got nothing. Half is just about going to end.
10 seconds remaining. So once again, another bitter disappointment for the Rams as they come up shy. Second scoring opportunity. They had a 34-yard field goal that they missed as a result of a nice drive. This time they moved to the one-yard line, failed to score. The pass interception. We have reached halftime, completed 30 minutes of play here at Meade Stadium in Kingston. We're at the end of two quarters of play. It is the University of Richmond 14 and the University of Rhode Island nothing. By Jim Norman and his staff, we will pass those on as well. It has been an even contest despite the fact that the Rams trail by 14 points. First downs, Rhode Island with 16, Richmond with 14. Third down conversions, the Rams have converted 4 of 10, Richmond 3 of 9. Penalties, the Rams 4 for 15, Richmond 3 for 25. The big difference certainly has been turnovers. The first pass interception resulted in a first quarter 57-yard touchdown scamper by Tony Butler, and the second touchdown as a result of a Richmond drive and a one-yard touchdown toss from quarterback Bob Blyer to wide receiver James Church. The two-point conversion on a pass from Blyer to Church, and that's the margin of difference in this game. It has been, really, despite the score, a hard-fought, evenly fought contest, and I would think if you're the Rhode Island coaching staff, you have to go back in and say, listen, keep doing the same things you're doing. Defense, please hold on. and hopefully we'll finally get this thing organized and able to push a ball in from the one-yard line.
I certainly wouldn't be too hopeful. I don't know. I was in situations in college the same way. We tried and tried and tried my sophomore year, and we just couldn't get through. We won three measly games, and we
tried
everything.
Let's take a look at that first touchdown, the pass interception, and as I said, this was with Rhode Island driving.
Simple play, just throws it to the
sideline.
Wrong man, picked off by number two, Tony Butler, sprints into the end zone. Unfortunately, URI doesn't have enough diversity in their offensive arsenal to break tradition. They seem to be doing the same offensive scheme over and over again. I was just talking to one of the JV, I guess, assistants, and he was saying...
Go ahead, Mike. I'm sorry, finish your thought.
That they don't have certain offensive schemes and that they used to have when I first viewed URI when I played ball.
Let me ask you this question. Watching the Bears stumbling to Minnesota a couple of weeks ago, there was a conversation in which they talked about quarterback scenarios in terms of the amount of plays that they have to learn and play selection and so forth because of the fact that their quarterback, their starting quarterback, McMahon, had been injured and they had to go with the backup. And what they talked about is that at the beginning of the week, when they come up with a game plan, as the week progresses,
that's the way it looks at
the end of the week, you wind up with really a handful, a half a dozen or eight running plays, and maybe a similar amount of passing plays. That the name of the game in football is...
Mal scores, you know, Richmond leading 14-0. First downs, Rhode Island has 16. That's their average for a game. They had 16 in the first half. Rushing yardage, 70 yards for Rhode Island, just 61 for Richmond. That's a big statistic there. Passing, Farland has 94 yards, Blyer 78. And you see the total yards, Rhode Island leading that as well. Time of possession, Richmond held that. As we take a look at Bobby Blyer on the sideline, number 16, the senior quarterback, coming into the game with 59% of his passes completed, 14 touchdowns, and just 7 interceptions. And the big play man, Brian Shields, number 20, who is not figured in this game, leads the team in touchdowns with 5. So again, let's get back to my point. What can they do differently? They move the ball well, 16 first downs.
Well, Rich, they've done everything they have to do except for put the ball in the end zone, as the athletic director has indicated earlier in the interview. But right now, I can tell you that they generally are outscored or out offense 3-1. And right now, they are ahead of Richmond, who is a high-powered offense. They are a very strong team. URI is putting together a good afternoon effort all along the lines inside the 20s, except for those key periods. They've cut down on the major mistakes that they usually had in the past 5 previous games, where they'd have a big play and then a big penalty. Right now they're doing well. Maybe the knot is beginning to tighten a little bit. The jello is beginning to gel. They're starting to get a little semblance of cohesiveness. And let's see the University of Rams put together a good second half to carry over into the remainder of the season. We are Rhode Island fans, and let's see what they can do for us.
There's the kick. Rams receiving on the far side of the field. 21 is Chris Poyer. Poyer with a burst of speed out past his own 30 to the 33-yard line. Up off the bottom of the pile for the Spiders, number 88 is John Henry. The Rams will own it, first and 10. Trailing by 14, just underway third quarter.
Important for Rhode Island to have a concerted offensive effort right now. They did that in the first period of play. First time they got the ball, a great drive, and they came up empty. And that might have set a different tone for this game if they scored first, because Richmond really hasn't played that well. In fact, they played pretty lax at times in this game.
From their own 33-yard line, Chris Poyer behind the quarterback. Nice play action. Farland to throw. Once again, high and overthrown. Farland just cannot seem to get the ball into the belly of his receivers, the intended receiver, Donfield. Third quarter of today's game brought to you in part by Courtesy RV. We grow on customer satisfaction. By your Rhode Island AMC dealers, now offering 0% financing. And by Citizens Bank. Second and 10. Football is at the 33-yard line. Farland once again with time. Pass into the belly that time of the tight end, Jim Muse. 6'3", 203-pound junior. Big target at 6'3", and he hit him right in the numerals.
Something you have to do on that pass, Matt. We saw that in the first half. Pretty much the same pattern. He kind of floated it in there. This time he zipped it right through the defenders.
In addition, there was another offensive receiver in the same vicinity. This is what they have to do. They've got to congest things and break away. They can't have one-on-one receptions because the defensive backs, Jordan and Butler, are having a field day of covering the receivers one-on-one.
17th first down of the contest for the Rams. They own it just inside their own territory at the 49. No offsides. You saw the movement. Big hole right side. Running back Poyer down to the 40-yard line, inside the 40 for yet another Ram first down. Mark Auker, the defensive safety, came from behind to make the stop.
We have a final call. Boston College 19, West Virginia 10.
Here's the simple delay that URI has used pretty effectively all year with Haynes at the running back. Cuts back to the inside, inside the tackle. Good blocking by number 79, Sellinger, and enabling Poirier to get inside for a big, strong 10-15-yard gain. Good drive right here. Let's see what they can do with it. First down at the 39-yard line.
Good news for Boston College. The Eagles beat West Virginia this afternoon. 19-10, I believe, was the final. So they come up now with victories back-to-back as they try to reverse what had been an awful slow start.
Playing pretty well right now. Sean Halloran finding his sea legs a little bit.
They've got 45 points in the Lambert Meadowlands Trophy selection, so perhaps this will put them up a little bit higher next week.
Donfield to the far side, Pratt to the near side, Poyer is the running back. 14:09 remaining third quarter. Rams driving. The drive started at their own 33. They own it first and 10 as a result of that nice effort offensively by Chris Poyer, having a great afternoon. Over the middle, pass complete to Poyer at the 30, at the 27-yard line. Once again, credit the offensive line for the Rams. They are giving Farland all kinds of time to throw. The stop made defensively by Troy Gray.
Farland had plenty of time in that particular play. He dropped back, stood in his pocket strong. There was no defensive players coming around him. He dropped back real deep, able to look over the field. He also had number 81, Steve Schwab, open in the flank from the tight end position. He elected to throw to Poirier. Good reception, good run. And again, we got another first down. This is their 18th first down in this game.
First and 10 from the 28-yard line. Off the right side is Poyer. Inside the 25 to the 22-yard line. Stop made defensively for the Spiders by Mark Auker again out of the secondary. That's what you want to see. If they're coming up from the secondary, you know that the offense is getting the job done. So a big pickup on the play. The Rams now are faced with a second and 5. The football at the 22-yard line. They trail by 14, but they are moving the ball.
That was a nice bit of instinctive running by Poirier. Looked like he was going outside. Instead, he cut it back inside.
Pratt and Donfield, the receivers. Donfield to the top of your screen. Pratt to the bottom. Poyer, nice hole, right side, 15, close to the 10-yard line.
Super run. Poirier is really taking control of the ball here. He's really taking the brunt of the offense on his shoulders right now. But you've got to credit the offensive line. They are facing a 34 defense, and it's allowing the defensive, the offensive ends and tackles to cut inside, create an alley. Poirier, with good speed and good football savvy, is able to find the opening, cut it up inside, and get the yardage necessary. He's doing a great job right there, and URI is on a scoring drive right here.
First and 10, the line of scrimmage is the 12.
Oh.
Pass is high and overthrown. That same out pattern, this time to Donfield. They must have missed that 7 or 8 times in the course of the afternoon. And once again, good coverage from Brian Jordan and Kim Pettis as they combine, but they really did not need to do much as the pass was just high and wide.
Mike, this is where I'm saying that an experienced quarterback would not even have thrown that ball. He had a blocker out in front of him. He may not be a big runner, but he could have stepped inside like an option quarterback, take it up inside, pick up 5 or 6 yards, and then avoid getting hit just by going down on the ground. Instead, he elects to throw the ball in traffic, fortunately incomplete.
Second and 10. The short drop, football up, off the hands of Troy Gray. You see 4 white shirts surrounding the intended receiver, Jimmy Muse, and I'm amazed that it got close, that close to Muse.
Wilkinson putting a lot of pressure on Farland, and he had to throw that ball in traffic once again. We see, there he is, number 98, it looks like, or it may have been 88. Well, we'll call it 98, Rafe Wilkinson, putting the pressure on him, and as you mentioned, Mike, 4 or 5 jerseys surrounding Jimmy Muse.
With all those people around them, someone else had to be open somewhere.
Rams, 4 of 10 in third down conversions. They are faced with their 11th, certainly the biggest of the afternoon. 3rd and 10 from the 12. No choice. Farland has to throw the screen pass. Hoyer to the 10-yard line, and that's all. 31 on the hit defensively out of the secondary. Kim Pettis had played much too much time to develop, and as a result, plenty of white shirts able to get to the general area and knock down the blocking, which allowed Pettis to make the stop.
May have worked, though. Chiava missed his block, and Pettis slipped in between him, making the stop there on Poirier.
Well, Poirier not as gifted a running back as Haynes, and who is, as we know, injured with a groin injury. If he had been there, perhaps his elusiveness may have been allowed him to get him the extra yardage necessary for the first down. But URI seems to be going for it. Let's see what they can do with this particular play.
Not going to go for the 3. They're going for 7. They trail by 14. 4th down and 9.
Oh!
Knockdown. Intended receiver was Pratt. Butler got his hand on it and knocked it away. Looked like it might have been good, but it was knocked down, and as a result, the Spiders able once again to thwart a Ram drive that started way back on the URI 33.
Farming, rolling to his right, half roll, firing the ball with a little bit of enthusiasm, a little bit of velocity, just gets it touched by Jordan, who's had a wonderful afternoon all day, and Pratt unable to pick up the ball. That's deflected a little bit.
55-yard drive. The bottom line, however, no points. Let's see if the Ram defense can bow their necks in this situation. Tailback slammed to the ground right at the line of scrimmage. The running back, Irwin Matthews, and Landry nailed him right at the line. If they can do this, they would force a punt, which would give them, once again, excellent field position. Kenny Kurtz, an assist on the play.
It's tough to really come up with anything to say about this, and it's plainly obvious.
No, URI is playing very, very well right now. They just can't, again, get that ball in. But let's see, they're deep in the territory. Let's see if they can hold them and get field position and go.
Lots of time. That's the good news. Lots of time. 2nd and 9. Once again, the tailback with 3 or 4 people pushing ahead. He moves outside the 15 to about the 17-yard line. Up off the bottom, number 58 is Damon Hewlett. The ball carrier number 22, T.J. Morgan, a 5'10", 190-pound sophomore fullback. He got 4, and that was nothing but brute strength. It will be now a 3rd and 4, another conversion call for the Spiders. They are 3 of 9 on the afternoon. To the bottom of your screen, Shields. Pass complete. Nice play, completion to Henry, the tight end on the play. Paul Granatelli from his safety position on the stop, but the first down conversion, and the Spiders get it out from the shadow of their own goal line. They started at their 12. They now own it at their own 27.
Henry, a real big target, just grabbed that ball in between two defenders making the reception. It's a big first, big first down conversion there.
That reminds you of Dan Ross of Northeastern several years ago.
9:54, third quarter off play action. Blyer puts it up, well overthrown. The only receiver in the vicinity was Shields, but he was covered by a couple of blue shirts. There's the case in point that you talk about. Blyer saw the coverage and elected just to throw it away.
Well, Cahey putting the pressure on him there.
And that allows Richmond, again, another play at the ball without having an interception or anything bad happen. You know, it's a mishap right there that URI was able to get inside.
Blyer suffered the same things that Farland is going through. You mentioned their record in the previous years. He's had his problems as well. He's learned under fire, so maybe Greg will do the same.
3-8 his first year at the helm, then 8-4 and 8-3. He is 3-3, and that's a disappointing 3-3, by the way, through 6 games here in 86. Flag down at the line of scrimmage. Pass is complete, and that time Henry used a screen by the line judge.
Great play.
To pick off the pass.
I was talking to the JV coach in the on the other side here, and I said, URI is having such a tough time. Why not use everything in the world that they possibly can? I mean, step right
they
on,
ought to use it.
Right on the fringes of the legalities of the rules. You can't use a screen if it's a referee. You can't use another player, but why not try it?
Penalty is against URI.
And I believe it was the 5-yard variety. It occurred just at the snap of the ball. It probably was an offside. Let's see.
Looked like somebody on the right side of the line was a little over-anxious.
They will save themselves a down as a result because they were shy with the completion to Henry. So they will, as a result, be faced with what looks like about a second and five with the football at the 32. Offsides. Second and five, football at the 32. It would have been a third and about two would they have elected to decline the penalty. 82 to the top of the screen is Church. To the bottom is Brian Shields. Shields is in motion behind his quarterback. Blyer to the tailback, Matthews. Matthews close to the first down. In fact, it looks like he got it, stopped by Jim Landry. Needed to get to the 37. He's very close.
Matthews very low to the ground, very shifty in his movements. His shoulder stays straight, but his body seems to go left and right. He's got some good quickness and tough little ball player, tough little runner.
Timeout on the field as they take a measurement with 9:18 remaining, 14 to nothing. Richmond will take a timeout back in a minute. Up behind the line of scrimmage, great defensive move there for the Rams by number 69, John Gilman, an impressive presence, 281-pound freshman from Westerly, as he wrapped his arms around the tailback for a loss on the play of four.
They're going to build their defense around that kid. He's a horse, as we're looking at Bobby Blyer, who I'm sure is a better quarterback than he's shown today. He's not been that impressive.
Westerly, where's Westerly? Second down
and 14. Faraway place.
Been, he must have been growing himself for quite a few years. 285 pounds. That's a big boy.
And mobile as well. In motion is Shields. Second and 14 from the 33. Blyer with time. Has a receiver. The pass is complete outside the 45. Ray Williams wrapping up the receiver on the play. 82 is Church. The ball at the 48. First down for Richmond.
Mike, I got to interject. I think that was the first running play that URI was able to stop them for a loss. And as the statistics have shown, URI has 460 yards of rushing offense, coupled with 263 yards of losses in the rushing department. That's only 260 yards total rushing.
They only had five last week.
Comparative to a team, or their opponents that have 1,400 yards rushing and only 200 yards of losses.
Well, it's just a matter of how you want to run your program, and obviously Bob Griffin has elected to go with the pass for the past two seasons. It obviously worked. And this time around, he's struggling, and as we have seen indication here today, they play a team that comes in as the preseason conference favorite along with Delaware, and they really are playing them head-to-head with the exception of the fact that they haven't been able to finish off drives. Other than that, this has been a dead-even contest as we take a look at the University of Richmond insignia there on a
I wouldn't even go that far to say it was dead-even. I think URI's outplaying them.
I think they are. I have to agree with Rich. They are outplaying them. They're being more aggressive. They're going to the ball. They're tackling more effectively. The problem is they're just not getting the ball into the end zone when they're supposed to.
So it's hard to imagine that this football program could be 0-6 at this point. 82-20, Church and Shields. The twin receivers set to the near side. At the top, the tight end, Henry. They give to the tailback, and he is met head-on at the line of scrimmage. Irwin Matthews, three blue shirts. They are beating them absolutely on the line of scrimmage. 73 is Jim Landry, 58 is Damon Hewlett. The two combine on the hit. And I got to believe that the Ram defense is going to grade out awful high this week when they take a look at it on film.
They've played this well all year. If the offense did what they did today, moving the football so often, the defense wouldn't have been on the field so much. Of course they're going to give up points if they're on the field a lot.
6:56 remaining third quarter, second and 14 for the Spiders. Bob Blyer. Preseason All-American selection, 1AA. He's a good one. Pass is complete. Great throw by Blyer under big pressure from Mulcahy. And the completion, nevertheless, to the receiver, James Church, who was covered by Anthony Adams. And that pass was low and hard. And as a result, Adams was able to fall to his knees, or rather, Church was, and haul it in.
You'll see the pressure coming from the outside from one of the URI defenders. He is able to hit Blyer, but he's still able to release the ball into Church's hands. Good reception, excellent defensive coverage. Nothing you can do about that.
But the only place he could have thrown it and completed the pass. Off the right side, the fullback head down. Big kid. We haven't seen him. Number 32, for the Richmond Spiders, we got to take a look at the spot chart for this one. It's a new face, Wilson, and he is a big guy. We're going to have to take a look at the program and check his size because he looked like a truck coming through the line.
There's a pickup for me. Second down and two.
Keith Wilson measures 200 pounds. He looked about 240 coming through the line, 5'11", out of Virginia Beach, Virginia. As he gets seven, it's second and three. Tailback Matthews, close to the 30-yard line. That's just about where they have to get for the first down. So if, in fact, he gets to the 30, they will have yet another first down. This drive began for Richmond on their own 12-yard line. It is reached now. The University of Rhode Island, 31. And it has also eaten up a heck of a lot of the clock as we take a look at the Richmond bench.
You see, Richmond's starting to open up their offense a little bit. First play of the second half, they had a man in motion. All first half, you didn't see that. They're starting to open up things, throwing a few more twists at the URI defense. Let's see if they can hold on to what they've been doing thus far and handle these little offensive twists by the Richmond Spiders.
Matthews now with 10 rushes for 35 yards. This is a young man that came in with 50 for 323, so he'd been averaging about 8 per carry. Matthews on the swing pass with a man to beat. Good speed. Eludes one defender. Finally tackled by Anthony Adams. He eluded the grasp.
Billy Brown, number 46.
Of Brown.
And Phil McKay, he was in the same vicinity also. So they were in the place. They knew what they did. For a screen pass or a swing pass such as that nature, 2.5 yards is not very effective. So credit URI with the win on that particular play right there.
Offense mixing it up. Blyer in the second half, 3 of 5 for 46 yards. It is a second and 8. Football is at the 27-yard line. We have 4:25 remaining in the third quarter. Richmond leads it by 14. Rams blew an excellent chance moments ago. They failed from the 12. Big hole, tripped up as he went through the line of scrimmage. Bill Brown got his hands on the ankle of Wilson. Otherwise, that young man would have moved all the way into the end zone.
He didn't even expect to get through, and when he did, he stumbled forward and tried to regain his balance. But he was headed for the end zone if he hadn't gotten tripped up.
Nice play selection as well, a little misdirection there.
Like I said, they're starting to open it up a little bit, and URI seemed to have a little more tough time.
Ram defense may be getting tired as well. They have put a lot of time out there on the field today, and up to this point, played remarkably well. Let's take another look.
Well, it's a crossback blocking. One of the guards cut across, picked up the inside man. And now we're coming back to live.
Quarterback rolling to throw. Blyer under pressure, just grounds the ball. I would think we'd see a flag. There is no receiver. I want to tell
you can see
the coaching staff, and they've got their
flag
hands
was
up.
Just dropped. Mike, near the 20-yard line.
Late call.
Yeah.
And I think Griffin made it.
Good call, too.
Griffin was in shouting distance of the referee on the far side of the field, and I believe that he had a word of encouragement for him when he did not see a flag.
A play then an experienced quarterback. You would think Blyer would have just went out of bounds on that one. He was pretty close to the sidelines and fired into the ground. And good break for URI there. They need something like that.
Penalties for Richmond now, 4 for 30 yards. That's a big one because it does move them back a bit as they were threatening to blow this open with yet another touchdown. That's still a possibility. You see the indication by Goldman, the grounding call, which will result in a loss of down, and it will give now Richmond a second and long. As the line of scrimmage was the 12-yard line, they are now all the way back on their 22, so they are faced with a second and 20. They've got to move all the way to the 2-yard line now, second and 20. Give inside to Wilson, the big battering ram fullback. He is stopped by Jim Landry, and I find it hard to believe that that young man is 200 pounds.
He seems to run up a lot straighter than you would see a person as a running back. They want to lean in a little bit more. He's running up straight, so it may give him the impression of being a little bit bigger than he actually is. Because even when he made that first move, he was wide open and his shoulders were open.
Third and 14, credit them with a pickup of 6. Football is at the 18. They need to get to the 2 for the first down, to the end zone for the touchdown. 3:03 third quarter, they lead by 14. Blyer knocked down nicely there by Ray Williams, defending on the intended receiver on the near side of the field. That's Brian Shields. Nice work by Williams, the defensive corner on the play.
There's a penalty flag down, and we have a clip against Richmond thrown back further. Okay.
Here you see the replay, Mel. Blyer got some time back there, and good coverage by Ray Williams on the receiver. Steps right in there and knocks the pass away. It would have been a spectacular reception if it was made by Brian
Shields.
Now,
what do you do in this situation? They're either faced with a third and 14, still in field goal range, or do you move them back with the clip? I would think they would to get them out of field goal range. Let's see what happens.
I believe they'll take that penalty because it's safe. They're at a position where if they go for the field goal, they'll get the ball where the ball is kicked if they decide to go for it, if they don't pick up any substantial yardage, and they've elected to take the penalty. So now they've got two more plays to get in relative close field goal range, and the probabilities are diminished being this far out.
Clip is the call, so Richmond continues their drive in the wrong direction. They had reached the 12-yard line. The football is now at the 33. They are faced now with a third down and 31. Third and 31 from the 33-yard line, 2:58 in the third quarter, a couple of breaks as a result of penalties favoring the Rams, who trail by 14. Blyer throws the home run ball. Intended receiver was James Church. Defending on the play, number one was Ray Williams, and he had some help out there as well from number 10, I believe. That's Aaron Smith. The pass, if it would have been hauled down, I believe the reception would have come out of the end zone, but you can see Blyer can air it out.
They have nothing to lose. He pump fakes once, looks downfield. I thought he would have picked out another receiver because Church was covered pretty closely in the corner of the end zone at the end line. Good reception. It was right there. I would have, again, they're punting right now, but I would have conceivably gone for another pass. I know this punter is going to kick it out of the end zone.
Looking for the corner. And he just can't seem to find it. He's not even close into the end zone. So the Rams will take over first and 10 from their own 20, trailing by 14 with 2:44 remaining third quarter. We're back in a minute.
How about over there?
Greg Farland with a pass completion to tight end Jim Hughes advances the football out from the 20 to the 28-yard line, where the Rams will be faced with a second and 2. The Rollins scoreboard indicates the situation. The scoreboard clock shows 2:22 remaining in the third quarter. Rams, the last time, moved the football from their own 33 to the Richmond 12, but could not move it in. It was finally picked off in the end zone.
All right, Mike, today's game brought to you, third quarter, brought to you by Courtesy RV. We grow on customer satisfaction as Chris Poirier breaks it to the outside and picks up some yardage. Don't mean to step on you there, Michael.
Poirier to the outside. He picks up first down yardage outside the 35-yard line, so it'll be a first down yet again for the Rams.
Time's winding down here at URI. It's 2:04 remaining in the third quarter, and URI's got the ball at their own 35-yard line.
We better get the record book out and see when the last time URI was shut out back-to-back games, if it does come to pass.
As well as they're moving, I still have to believe in my heart they'll be able to move it in. Dropping to throw is Farland.
Oh.
Farland looking for Pratt, and once again, as we talked about early, and we probably are being a bit too critical, but he is having his problems. Farland, with all kinds of open field to run, still elected to try and indicate to his receiver to move around, as these youngsters are doing. They've seen enough. Their backs are turned on the action, so they're somewhat frustrated like all of us. Makes a great slide, doesn't it?
Looks like the URI program is sliding down a little bit here.
Oh, that was a low blow. Oh.
He may need an escort past John Chuckren's box on the way out. On the far side of the field, Muse has it at the 35. Great effort by the tight end out to the 37-yard line. The line of scrimmage, however, the 35, it was a lot of effort for not a lot of yardage. It will necessitate another third down conversion call for the Rams. It'll be a third and 8 football at the 37-yard line. They need to get to the 45. We've got a minute and a half remaining. Farland, 4 of 7 in this half for 22 yards. Pratt to the near side. Top of the screen is a very inactive for him, Bobby Donfield. He has been covered like a blanket today. Passes up in the direction of Donfield. No flag on the play as he was held up momentarily there by Brian Jordan. And you would think that just to get him into the contest, they would run some short patterns in front of the defender. They continue to try and beat Jordan deep without much success. So it will be a punting situation. Centauri is on the field. They'll have to give up the football now, and Richmond will take over, and they have the 14-point cushion.
I'll have to refresh my memory, but I don't remember if Greg has been sacked at all today. I don't believe he has.
No, he hasn't.
He's had a great deal of time back there to throw the football. He's just not having a good day throwing it.
Poor kick, but it does take a ram bounce inside the 35 to the 32-yard line where the Richmond Spiders will take over. And once again, the Ram defense will be faced with the ominous task of trying to thwart any scoring bid. The Rams at this point certainly cannot afford to let Richmond put anything more on the board. We're back in a minute. Credit the Ram defense, despite the score, with a great effort. Damon Hewlett on that occasion bringing the ball carrier down. He got very little, if anything, an assist to Mulcahy on the play. In fact, they are going to call it a loss of a yard. It'll be second and 11 now for the Spiders. They lead by two touchdowns.
This high-powered offense has been shut down. The past two games, they averaged 48 points, beating up on some teams. Not Rhode Island today. This defense has shut them right down.
By the way, Centauri's punt, not a good one, just 32 yards. Flyer airs it out. Some bumping on the play. No flag, however, as Ray Williams was step for step with number 82, James Church, the split end for the Spiders. Flyer not having much success going deep either today.
Good coverage back there by Ray. He has bore a lot of the criticism about the Rams secondary as well. He's the only veteran left. Lost some great players from last year's secondary, of course. The guy up in the booth at this right now, Tony Hill.
Spiders, 4 of 12 with third down conversions. They're faced with their 13th. They are third and 11. The football is at their own 30-yard line. We have 12 seconds remaining in the third quarter, and Richmond leads the University of Rhode Island 14 to nothing. Blyer off play action. Good pressure, and the pass is complete to Church, and he is close. No, it is dropped. They call it complete. The indication on the wave, I believe, was to stop the clock, to reset the chains. First down, and he knew where he was going. He needed to get to the 42. You see where he got. He got to the 43-yard line. Nice pass by Blyer, who took a heck of a shot from Damon Hewlett.
Blyer stood strong in the pocket, threw the ball to the receiver, Church, who was hit immediately by Aaron Smith. And he brought him down at that point of impact, but the receiver and the quarterback knew the distance that they had to go, executed the play for the first down.
22nd first down in the contest for the Spiders. We have now completed three quarters of play here at Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island. Mike Lyons with Rich D. Simone. We hope you are enjoying the broadcast. We're back with the fourth quarter in just a minute. Favor, except the score at this point. We are just underway in the fourth quarter. Richmond owns a 14-point lead, and they own the football in Ram territory, and they're about to walk it off a bit deeper. Big smiles on their faces. I'm not quite sure why. Maybe they know something we don't. Walk-off was against the Spiders, the penalty against Richmond. So they own it now, first and 15 in their own territory at the 37-yard line. Blyer will throw. Once again, great reception. Good hands by Church. That pass was high, but Church was able to hold on before Ray Williams wrapped him up and down at about the 47. So he got back the 5 plus about 7. It will be a pickup of 12, and it will result now in a second and about 4.
Church, the rare combination of a guy who is a deep threat but has good hands as well, plenty of time to throw it, and great concentration and a super reception there in front of Ray Williams.
A lot of diversity in the backfield allowed that play to develop.
Give us to that big fullback, Wilson, the ball carrier. Landry drags him down. He got a couple but did not pick up the first down. It will be a third and a 1.
Chris Santapietro as well in on that hit. Plenty of time left, 13:38 and counting right now in this fourth quarter. Rhode Island's defense has to stiffen up right now and get the ball back in good position.
third and one. The Spiders 5 of 13 with respect to third down conversions. They're faced with their 14th. They send a receiver, Church, to the far side, and to the near side, Brian Shields. The fullback, 22, T.J. Morgan. And the give off the right side with room to run. He's got the first down to the Ram 40-yard line. The running back is number 19 for Richmond. And that's Robinson, another new name, new face for Richmond. He picks up the first down to the 41.
Simple high tailback play where the back is able to go either left or right, whatever he sees, chooses to go outside, good blocking, good strong running, puts his head down, drives his legs for an extra 4 or 5 yards. Good play.
Spiders happy to eat up the clock at this point. 12:55 to play. They lead by 2 touchdowns. Blyer. Matthews eludes the grasp of Hewlett, who was up from his linebacker position and very nearly wrapped him up in the backfield. He is eventually brought down by number 27, Paul Granatelli. He picks up about 3 on the play. We'll call it now a 2nd and 7.
A little bit different running style from Matthews to Williams. Williams is a little bit high, and you see Matthews is really, really low to the ground and shifty.
Temperature has dropped noticeably here in the course of the contest. Sun was out early. Everybody bundled up now at this point, although I would estimate that the temperature is hovering at about the 50-degree mark at this point, a slight breeze. 12:06 remaining. Blyer off the short drop. The receiver, Shields, stumbled on the play but was able to recover, haul down the pass, move inside the 30 for yet another Richmond first down. And once again, Aaron Smith defending on the play.
That's a question of the Rhode Island defense, as it's happened all throughout the season, wearing down a little bit.
You've got Blyer just takes a 3-step drop and finds his receiver, Church, who stumbled a little bit as we indicated earlier, was quick enough to turn his body. If he had not whipped his shoulders around to make that reception, it would have bounced off his back shoulder pad. He was able to quickly recover, catch the ball, and get the first down.
Back in motion with Shields. Give off the right side to the tailback, Matthews. Jimmy Happy, the linebacker, 6'2", 215-pound junior from New York, New York, the second leading tackler for the Rams, involved in the hit. Pickup of 3 on the play, 2nd and 7, 11:17 left to play. The clock continues to move.
Quick opener right there. You see, again, from the eye tailback position, which I'm very partial to, it allows the tailback to do a lot of things that otherwise, in the setback position, you're unable to do. Picked up a big opening, ran through it, and just bowled over Happy, who made the tackle.
Blyer. Reception on the far side to Shields. Richmond offense moving a little bit better at this point in the contest, whether that's because of the fact that the Rams are tired or whether it's because Blyer and his troops are getting untracked, we're not sure. This is an explosive offense.
I think it's more attributable to the fact that they began to open it up a little bit more in the second half. Like I said, they have men in motion. They're using a lot of cross action in the backfield alignments before they get the ball off. And the quarterback is just very, very relaxed and confident out there throwing the ball.
Off the side, off to the tailback with room to run. Matthews into the end zone. Irwin Matthews, a 5'9", 185-pound sophomore, negotiates the final 15 yards on a drive that began at the Richmond 32-yard line. So at this point, the Ram defense finally wearing down, and that may be the one that seals it. The Rams now trail by 20.
Like I said, again, Mike, here's the play. You see that the quarterback just gives the ball to Matthews, who has exceptional speed, switches the ball to the outside hand, closer to the sideline, switches again inside, which again makes you a little bit more elusive. One of the things that a good running back will do will keep the ball to the outside, but there are those times that he keeps it on his inside hand and gives him a little bit more mobility.
Extra point attempt is up, and it is good. So with 10:33 remaining in the football game, Richmond moves out on top of the University of Rhode Island, 21-0.
Hi, I'm Moses Tutupu of the New England Patriots. If you're thinking of buying or renting an RV, see what Courtesy RV has to offer.
You picked a winner with Courtesy, ranked as a leader in southeastern New England for selection. Courtesy also offers full-service Rhode Island vehicle inspection, the right replacement parts, and a full line of accessories. Best of all, they treat customers the way their name implies.
Now that's courtesy.
This is Jeep's all-new 4-liter six-cylinder.
Wait to see the indication by the referee, Joel Goldman.
We got a fair catch there.
The kickoff is taken by Zarella.
We have a fair catch on that particular play, something that you don't usually see too often. I guess because he's one of the up men, he's probably instructed, don't run with the ball because you may drop it.
Well, so that cost him. That was that led to the, it didn't lead to one of the scores, as a matter of fact, but it did give an excellent opportunity to the Spiders earlier today when, in fact, a very poor kick was fumbled by the upfront people for the Rams. So the Rams take over first and 10 at their own 20, trailing by 21 points. And now they can tee off because they know that Farland has to go to the air. The pass reception to Poyer up close to the 30-yard line. That's the marker. That's where they need to get for the first down. Wilkinson, the man involved on the stop defensively for the University of Richmond.
Getting a little chilly this afternoon as the day is winding down here in Kingston. Temperature dropping a little bit. Game of ifs. If URI scored on their first possession, they would have had great field position if they didn't fumble that horrendous kick by Richmond there. Who knows what this game would have been like?
Unfortunately, right now, they're relegated to the same statistical probability where they get to pass the ball and increase their yardage, but not really make any big dent in the game.
Pass is overthrown. Farland looking for Jimmy Pratt. That's the speedster. That's the first time we've seen them try and air it out in his direction all afternoon. Overthrown and incomplete.
Had a couple of steps, too. Showing his great speed on that sideline pattern.
Farland, 5 of 11 in the second half for 31 yards, so as you can see, the yardage negligible at best. Take a look at the Richmond sideline. They've got to be pleased. They will pick up their fourth victory of the season and avenge the playoff loss that they suffered here a couple of years ago. Farland to Schwab over the middle of the 35-yard line, so they make the third down conversion. They pick it up. It is first and 10 now at their own 35-yard line.
Schwab's a good-looking player, just a sophomore.
He seems to come to his own, and he's really impressed me in what he can do with the football after he gets a hold of it and in his pass pattern running.
See, their backup quarterback, Chad Greer, was warming up. Maybe they'll give Bobby Blyer the rest of the day off.
Boy, the ball carry out close to the 40-yard line, run out of bounds on the far side of the field. We may have seen a flag. There is an injured Ram on the play as well. They don't need that. It's a 70, I believe it's 79. That's John Sellinger,
who's had an outstanding game all day long. He's been able to contain the defensive ends of Richmond and allow the running back Poirier to get outside. Let's see if it's just a nominal sprain or perhaps a bone bruise, something.
And that line has been under duress. As we mentioned coming in, they had allowed Farland to be sacked on 30 occasions in the course of the year. And to this point in the contest, unofficially, we have yet to see Farland dropped on the seat of his pants. We'll be back in just a minute. Farland drops the throw. He's got a receiver, and that ball was in the air. Now, loose football. Poyer, I don't believe so. I think he was down before he lost it. Let's see. That's not the case. The indication, very obvious there, as you take a look at the white-clad Richmond Spiders trotting off the field. Loose football recovered by Richmond. We will see for Richmond, Blyer back in at the helm, so they elect to stay with their veteran signal caller. Let's take another look.
Farland throws the ball. Good reception. Again, Poirier, I believe, is a receiver in the receiving end.
He wasn't down.
As he was getting tackled, spun around, and the ball shot forward. Was able to get recovered by number 38.
Muscues continue to kill the Rams here today. Long pass, pick up and off. The intended receiver on the play for Richmond was number 27, Hargrove, and that was a perfect toss from Blyer. He could not, however, hold on.
Blyer showing his offensive punch here. He can really throw the ball. He's airing it out with a nice arc on the ball, throwing it down to number 27, and it's completed between the two defenders, but unable to hold on to the ball. And again, it's an incomplete pass, but we have a penalty. It seems to be being marched off against Richmond. We'll see what the call is indicated in a moment.
Now, we neglected to mention the name Bob Blyer, the last name probably familiar to many football fans, the cousin of one of the probably the gutsiest football players you'd ever want to see, and that's Rocky Blyer, the great running back for the Pittsburgh Steelers back in their heyday in the 70s, teaming up with Franco Harris and Terry Bradshaw. That was an unbelievable team. I'm sure we all remember that one.
Here's something that should startle all of us. Blyer in the second half, we'll get to that in just a minute, 9 of 15 for 95 yards, but I'll get to a point I want to make in just a minute that I find remarkable. Nice hole off the right side, still on his feet, inside Ram territory to the 40-yard line. The ball carrier on the play for Richmond was Robinson, finally hauled down by Granatelli, and this has not got to sit too well with Rhode Island. They've kept their first team in all the way as they look like they want to run up the points. Next week, Richmond will face the University of Georgia in Sanford Stadium, which seats 82,000. They have met them twice in their history, losing 23-7, and in 75, losing 28-24.
It's not bad, a Division I AA team playing a Division I power, and we're talking power, of course. Vince Dooley, a renowned coach in the college football circles.
We'll be watching that score.
Yeah.
That is remarkable. That is certainly a step up in competition.
And obviously makes them tougher, too. They're playing a Division I team. They come in the next week and play a Division I AA school. They're obviously going to be a little more tested.
We just heard a big score here. That University of Maine lost 35-19, I believe, at the hands of UConn. So that really changes things a little bit. And BU is beating UMass 19-14 in the fourth quarter. That may change things around a little bit and give this Richmond team something to look forward to.
Blyer looking to go for the home run ball. He's got a receiver into the end zone. The defender on the play, Anthony Adams, totally turned around. And the receiver on the play for the University of Richmond, Hargrove, that's the man who dropped one a moment ago. This time he was able to get behind the secondary, confuse the defender on the play, and move in for 6 points.
Again, Blyer just standing in the pocket, throwing a little bit off balance. He was a little bit broader than he should have been. Fires the ball up in the air. It hangs a little bit longer than it should. But on that particular play, it was a blessing in disguise because the defender overran the ball. The receiver knew the ball was coming, turned around, simple basket catch, and stepped into the end zone. Hargrove with the reception, and that's the fourth touchdown, a beautiful field goal in the fall foliage here at Mead Stadium. And then we're going to go for a break, Mike.
How about over there?
Courtesy has your chariot waiting. Chariot Van, that is. Where a new tradition begins. Or try this Pinnacle and Windjammer Supersize. They both offer the luxury you deserve and the quality you can feel by establishment.
We all have our favorite campsites. Oh, Lydia.
Crazy Carlo here with some hot deals for you. I have these special Ben Giovanni Edition Cougars that are simply beautiful. You can be driving this special designer series for as little as $49 down. We also have the most popular car in the world, the Ford Escort, equipped with the Northeast Special Value Package for the lowest prices around. $49 down puts you into the driver's seat. So come on in to King Ford Mercury Route 140 in Milford and say hello to me, Crazy Carlo, and get the hottest deals around on new Fords, new Mercurys, and Ford trucks. You'll be glad you did.
King Ford Mercury, Route 140, Milford, Mass.
Welcome back to Mead Stadium. It is out of control at this point, 28-0 Richmond. It will read that way in the paper tomorrow, and most people won't believe that the Rams, for the most part, played a pretty good football game here today. That's Pratt with the football, outside the 30 to the 32, where the Rams will take over first and 10. Blyer's touchdown throw to Marvin Hargrove, 44 yards in all. Hargrove is a burner. He's a 5'9", 160-pound freshman from Willingboro, New Jersey. And you can see the speed that he showed on a previous play when, in fact, he had the football split two defenders but couldn't hold on. And on that occasion, as a result of the fact that Adams just got reversed and couldn't follow the football, he was able to come back to the ball, pull it in, and go into the end zone. 44 yards in all. Touchdown, Richmond. They lead it 28-0. Gilani into the game now as he throws on the far side of the field to Ray Studley. Studley, a reserve tight end, and Gilani, the backup quarterback. Gilani is southpaw. The reception is good, and the Rams have it out at their 40-yard line where it'll be second and one. Errol Robertson in defense for Richmond.
I'm not the second guess, Bob Griffin. Let's see what this Gilani kid can do. He did it once before. He looked real effective. We thought he was going to play a little bit more. Let's see if he can put together some semblance of an offensive drive.
Gilani eludes the rush. Pass is overthrown on the far side of the field. The intended receiver for the University of Rhode Island was Foster, Emerson Foster. The pass incomplete, third and a yard.
Now, it's admirable how Coach Bob Griffin is stuck by Greg Farland, but, you know, after six games, sometimes you have to make a change. You don't want to hurt the kid's feelings, obviously. You don't want to hurt his confidence, but
there's a lot of money being put into these football programs, and the fans and the administration expect to have a winning program, and you've got to go with the best people out there, so feelings are not an important factor here.
First down picked up there for the Rams. They will own it at that point. First and 10 from their own 46 as we have just under 7 minutes to play in the contest.
They have to be scratching their head, both the offensive and defensive unit. The offense has to be saying, well, we've moved the football about as well as we can. And they take a look at the scoreboard, and there's a big goose egg there. And the defense has really controlled. In the second half, Richmond diversified their offense, as Mal said, and began to open it up a little bit more. Consequently, they put some points on the board.
Reception at midfield, hauled down there for the Rams by number 26. That's Dave Morrill and Jack Henrietta, an outside linebacker, really dropped a shoulder into him. Pickup of 4, 2nd and 6.
It's tough to see what this Gilani can do because he's with the second core of receivers right now, but I hope he will do an impressionable job to perhaps get him in a little bit more for the future.
Gilani. That one looks high, but it is complete. Hauled down by Brian Mitchell, so an entire new core of receivers in there for the University of Rhode Island. Mitchell, who is an ex-basketball player at 6'5", hauls it down at the Richmond 30-yard line. First and 10 for the Rams.
You know, Mike, you indicated something earlier, that the score is 28-0, and tomorrow we'll look in the paper, and that's how it may end up. It's unfortunate because 1 year ago today, or 1 year ago on a similar afternoon, we couldn't say that. 28-0 was nothing for Earhart and his gang, and unfortunate that we can say that pretty confidently, that they are not going to win this game.
Gilani's got a receiver on the near side, down the sideline.
All right.
6 points for the Rams, so the University of Rhode Island averts the touchdown, or the shutout rather, on the touchdown toss from Paul Gilani. 2 for the University of Rhode Island, Brian Mitchell. Mitchell hauls it into the end zone. No flags, or what do we have here? They may be bringing it back.
Well, here's the replay. You see Gilani rolling to his left. Being a left-hander, it goes to his advantage. Throws the ball to the receiver number 92, Brian Mitchell. Eludes a tackler and just skirts down the sideline. Nice play. That's what URI needs. Diversification, wide open play. Unfortunately, it was brought back. That is the tale of URI football as of this year. The big penalty, the big mistake that just totally throws a monkey wrench into everything. And there you see some despondent fans. If you pan the upper stands, I'd say 50% of the people have gone home already.
More than that at this point. I'd say about 75%. And at this point, Bob Griffin wants to have a word with the referee on the far side of the field. He may be questioning that call, which resulted in negating the touchdown toss from Gilani to Brian Mitchell. And I'll tell you something else I'm a bit surprised at, and there may be some conversation about it after the game, the fact that Dale Sheely, with a 21-point lead and 7 minutes remaining in the game, not only kept his first team in, but continued to try and air it out to put more points on the board. That's something that's a bit unusual at this level of competition, and I would think that it may be addressed in the press tomorrow morning.
You don't win friends among your coaching peers doing something like that. A guy by the name of Jimmy Johnson, the coach of Miami of Florida, has done that a few times and gotten a lot of criticism for that.
You know, Mike, I was scouring the record book finding out when the last time Rhode Island was shut out in back-to-back games. It wasn't as far as I thought. 1979 was the last time. Around mid-season, Massachusetts shut them out up in Amherst, 24-0. And then the following weekend, Mal's old alma mater, Boston University, also shut them out 7-0. So you have to go back to 1979, the last time Rhode Island was shut out in back-to-back games.
Rhode Island huddling at their own 43-yard line. At this point, just trying to salvage some pride, save some face. They certainly played well here this afternoon. You take a look at the game films, there are going to be some people that grade out very well, particularly on the defense and the offensive line that has blocked well here today. There has been no quarterback sacks. On the near side of the field, the pass complete to the University of Rhode Island's Dave Morrill from Gilani as he moves inside the 35, but once again, we've got flags down on the play.
Seems to be a flag on the play, personal foul, or someone either punched somebody. I think that's what it was. It seems that the referee indicated to one of the line judge or the back judge that someone shoved the fist under someone's face mask, probably out of anger or frustration, because that tends to happen when someone does something wrong.
Referee talking it over with the defensive captain for the University of Richmond, and obviously Troy Gray and the Spiders would like to retain their shutout, as at this point, with 5.5 minutes to play, they're blanking the Rams 28-0.
Well, next up for Rhode Island, another awfully tough game. Have to go on the road and face University of New Hampshire. Bill Bowes, legendary coach in New England. A very good team again, New Hampshire has, as they always do. So when is URI going to win a game? I guess they have to hope for the game against Southern Connecticut.
And next week it's going to be a little bit colder than it has been. It's going to be up in New Hampshire, so that may affect the passing game of the University of Rhode Island.
New Hampshire playing Northeastern in a non-league game today. They started the day at 6-1. They are 3-1 in a three-way tie for first place with Delaware and UMass. But the last UMass score we had had BU in the lead. So should the Minutemen drop that contest, New Hampshire and Delaware would be alone atop the conference. Delaware as well involved in a non-league contest with Lehigh today. So a walk-off against the Rams.
Quite a walk-off.
It's like a 30-yard penalty. The 30-yard penalty.
The referee still conversing on the far side of the field with Bob Griffin, who is not pleased at all. We do not see any indication at all. He just wound the clock. I did not see an indication. There must have been an unsportsmanlike call on top of the penalty to necessitate the 30-yard walk-up. Gilani in a huge hole. He puts it up. Pass is complete again. Inside the 35-yard line, and once again for the University of Rhode Island, Brian Mitchell. I don't know what he's doing, but he's been all alone and open on just about every pass that's been thrown in his direction here in the fourth quarter.
Mike, I got to tell you, I like this kid Gilani. I like the way he looks back there, and I like the way the first time I saw him, and I'd like to see him in there more often. He drops back with authority, sets up with defiant aptitude, fires the ball into the hands of Mitchell, who again is on a crossing pattern. URI hasn't done a crossing pattern all day long. Crossing pattern, Mitchell's able to catch the ball, run into a couple of people, picks up some substantial yards. It's second down and 12.
Not
down
bad. First and 40. That's not too shabby.
Gilani under pressure. Loose football.
The flag's down. A lot of extracurricular activity going on there right now.
He
not
passed
necessary.
The ball forward, so I believe it would be a forward pass. It is not a lateral, and as a result, there will be no fumble. He did pass it to a back with a two on him in the person of Dave Morrow, so I believe it will be an incompleted pass, which will result in a third and 12 as opposed to a third and about 30 again. Good pressure. That's the closest the Spiders have come to sacking a quarterback.
Number 48 on that particular play was Gary Hintz, and he came right up the gut, and he was able to put a little pressure on Gilani, who got his feet crossed up, but what he did is just offer this quick shuffle pass forward. He knew it being out of end was completed, but he was able to avert a sack. Good play, good heads up, smart ball playing right there.
Scoreboard clock indicates 4:19 remaining in this contest, 28-0, Richmond over Rhode Island. You're watching a Rollins Sports production of University of Rhode Island football. I'm Mike Lyons, along with Rich DeSimone and Mal Najarian and our entire Rollins Sports production team. It has been a beautiful afternoon for football out here And through two periods, perhaps even three, it had been an excellent football game. The Spiders making a rout of it here in the final 15 minutes, and as a result, chasing a good many of the several thousand people who are out here watching the game today. As you can see, many of the fans have left the stadium at this point.
Even the referees and the scorekeepers or the marker holders are having a tough time. Now it's the first time that we've indicated. So there's a lot of confusing in these past 2 minutes right here. Penalties and flagrant fouls and stuff of that nature. And they just picked up 42 yards for first down somehow. On top of that reception by Mitchell, of course.
As we said, there's a lot of punching and grabbing and pushing and shoving and everything else you could think of going on out there right now. Rhode Island's frustration really coming to play at this point.
No indication by the referee in terms of what resulted, what the violation was that resulted in the Ram first down. Nevertheless, they own it first and 10 from the 22. Head on into the center of the line. The tailback Morrill is met at the line of scrimmage and put down hard at that point. Credit on the play to number 77, Tom Coles, along with number 49, Carvalho. They've got plenty of substitutions in as well. So as you look at many new numerals and new player personnel for the Rams offensively, it appears that the Spiders have relented somewhat, and they do have some substitutions on the field defensively with 3:49 to play and a 28-point lead. Galani to throw. Reception is good. That's Studley inside the 15-yard line. Ray Studley hauled it in. Mike Ogborn defending on the play. Studley, number 34, with the reception. A first down for the Rams as they look to avert back-to-back shutouts. That hasn't occurred for how long, Rich?
1979.
Galani, again, rolling to his right this time. Sets up quickly, fires the ball right into the hands of number 34.
Ray Studley.
Ray Studley, again, another tight end, another fine line of receivers that the University of Rhode Island has. Picks up enough in order to have them perhaps measure for a first down.
And hello to you, too. Some of the hardcore faithful, I would have to believe that those have to be perhaps some of the girlfriends of some of the players, because it would take that kind of allegiance to remain out here, situation being what it is.
Today we're getting some excellent camera shots, and today, as a benefit to that, we're getting to see who the people are holding the cameras. We've seen some of the ground crew cameras, and I guess there's the booth camera right there.
That's the game camera that follows the plays,
and we, of course, have the end zone camera and the mobile cameras.
First and 10 for the Rams now. Galani to throw. Football is in the air on the far side. Into the end zone. Touchdown, Rhode Island. The touchdown throw from Ball Galani to Steve Potasik, the wide receiver. Potasik into the game, and the little guy hauls one in for the touchdown. As the Rams avert the touchdown and put 6 points on the board.
A well-deserved touchdown. Excellent job. I'm really happy. We'll see again Galani throwing the ball, firing the ball defiantly right into the hands of Potasik, Steve Potasik, number 30, for the score. They had that same score just 3.5 minutes ago. Unfortunately, they had a recap and go right back the same distance to get those same 6 points.
Extra point attempt by Griffin. The kick is up. Flags are down. The kick is good. Hold everything.
I'm sure after Potasik went in the end zone, everyone on URI turned around to see if a flag was down on the field. Shocked to see that they got in the end zone. Good for them, though.
Team colors for the University of Rhode Island, blue and gold. Certainly one of their least favorite colors here this afternoon, yellow. They've seen a lot of that. Welcome back to Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island. This portion of today's football game, the fourth quarter, being brought to you in part by Citizens Bank. They're with you every step of the way. Spiders of Richmond, unfortunately, have been with the Rams every step of the way here this afternoon. As a result, they lead it 28-7. We have 3:15 remaining in the contest, and one bright note in the gloom here has been the work of Paul Galani, who has come in with everybody in the stadium, including the Richmond defense, knowing he had to go up on top, and yet despite facing that situation, he's able to move the Rams into the end zone for their only score of the afternoon.
Well, Mike, you got to remember against Towson State, Galani got in there, and we talked. That boy has never lost a game.
Onside kick, and the Rams may own it.
All right.
Okay.
Mike Griffin with the onside kick, so look at him. He's elated. Nice to see there's no quitting the Rams at this point. One of the real highlights of the game here this afternoon, something you might not expect, trailing 28-7 with 3:15 to go, and it certainly caught the Spiders looking. Take another look.
Well, remember, the ball has to go 10 yards, so Griffin does it very effectively. He kicks it right in front of his own grasp, and at the 9 3/4 yard mark, reaches out, pulls that ball into his chest, rolls forward 10 yards, first down, great play.
Galani, under pressure, puts it up. It's high and deep and yes! Caught. Touchdown, Rhode Island. Paul Galani to Emerson Foster. Galani appeared to be caught in the backfield, regained his feet and his composure, aired it out, and the result, a touchdown throw to Emerson Foster, and the Rams in the waning moments of the contest have gone from a possible back-to-back shutout situation to putting 14 points on the board.
Mike, I love this kid. He's ecstatic. He's electrifying. Throws the ball, fires it across the field. Had to be 45 yards in the air. Able to get the ball to the receiver. Picks it in Emerson Foster for the touchdown. Unbelievable play. But like I was saying before, after this, Mike, go ahead.
51-yard touchdown throw. The extra point attempt is up and good. The Rams, now with some extracurricular activity on the field. They're not pleased, Rhode Island, with the way Richmond tried to run up the score, and they have not yet quit. We'll be back with more action here from Meade Stadium in just a minute. With a certain defeater this afternoon, trailing 28-0 with just about 5 minutes to play in the game. They've put now two touchdowns on the board in a period of about 2 minutes. And take a look at the Spiders now. They are not chancing any more onside recovery possibilities, although I would think we are going to see an onside kick of some sort or another. They have what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They have 10 men.
But Michael, remember, you've got to remember the ball only has to travel 10 yards. If Griffin is talented enough with the ball and can loft it above their heads, they can have a couple of people just almost catch that ball in the air just beyond that second wave of people. So this may not be the best alignment that can be placed in there, but this is what they've gone with. But like I was saying before, I want to get this point across. When Galani has played in high school, he has never lost a football game ever that he started in. So that's something that we should look
from Natick High School,
of course,
Natick High School,
even in the same school that Doug Flutie went to.
There it is.
There you go.
Deep enough. However, it's picked off at the 40, the 38-yard line for the Spiders by number 27, Hargrove, so they had a back in there, and he was able to haul it down. Nice effort. Nevertheless, this time the Spiders are able to pull it off. There's 3:05 to play, so it's definitely possible that the Rams can get the ball back.
Excuse me, Mike. I believe there's a penalty on the play, and the referees just picked it up, so perhaps it wasn't...
Declined. The Spiders own it.
I think it was just offsides that they tried to...
There was a Ram offsides in terms of trying to get the quick start to go down for the onside kick. Spiders own it. They don't need to see another onside kick from 5 yards back and give them another opportunity.
You know what kick they could have used? The kick that Richmond did in the early first half. It was real high.
Blyer remains at quarterback. His club leads 28-14. Left side, faked inside, moved outside to midfield, still on his feet. What a run for the Richmond Spiders by a number 19, that's Robinson. We have seen some of the reserve backs for Richmond look even more impressive than the starters here today.
Right, Grooms was having problems running the football in the first half, URI's defense king on him. Matthews did a good job, and they seem to have a lot of depth at the running back position.
Well, Grooms has been injured, as we know, in the late waning minutes of the first quarter. I don't see him on the sideline, so he's probably back in the locker room with either ice on his ankle or whatever it may be, or perhaps they even took him to the hospital to see for x-rays.
Brian Robinson is a 5'9", 190-pound freshman tailback, so it's obviously been a pretty good recruiting year for the Spiders. Blyer, same man, same move to the opposite side. Faked inside, looked to go outside. Nice move defensively by Kurt Brockwell, a reserve linebacker. The Rams need to hold here so they can get the football back. They trail by 2 scores. Richmond with 26 first downs in the contest unofficially. 2nd and 10. In fact, they're going to credit him with a loss of a yard, and we'll call it 2nd and 11 now. Great work defensively. The picture pretty well tells the story. Nose tackle John Gilman wraps up the ball carrier on the play for Richmond. The ball carrier, number 32, Wilson, and he got absolutely nothing. Keith Wilson, another freshman, 5'11", 200-pound freshman fullback.
Well-stocked at running back. Wilson and Robinson are freshmen. Matthews is a sophomore, and he's going to bore the brunt of the Richmond offensive attack, I'm sure, in the years to come.
And we saw Hargrove, the flanker, the burner, who hauled down the touchdown pass a while back.
Mike, I understand they accredited this timeout to URI, but this should have been the 2-minute timeout. I believe there's 1 minute and 55 seconds, so I'm not sure if that will be rectified or not. Right now, URI has certainly taken a change of events with the electricity that Paul Galani is showing to the fans and to us here in the broadcast booth. Thanks, Mike. But right now, there's a little change of events. They've put a couple of scores on the board, something to grow on. This is very, very important for URI. They have to have a good, strong finish to have a respectable season for those seniors that don't have another chance, as we do with Damon Hewlett.
I know that sounds hard to believe, I'm sure, to some of our viewers, the fact that what difference does it make 28 to nothing or 28 to 14, but when you put the effort, that the kind of effort that the Ram people put into this game today, particularly on the lines, offensively and defensively, to come up with nothing certainly would have been disappointing. Excellent work defensively there for the University of Rhode Island by Chris Santapietro, who comes in and wraps up Blyer and sacks the Richmond quarterback.
Big play here. You know, we're looking at it was 1 minute and 55 seconds. That was a big play. They came in with a blitz, and Santapietro, the defensive end, was able to get to the quarterback unscathed and put a big hit on him and lost about 15 yards.
Rams once again ask for a timeout as they will be faced now with a 4th and long, a 4th and 28 at their own 36-yard line. Richmond will be forced to punt. That means the Rams will, in fact, get the football back and have yet another opportunity to put some points on the board. Not too many minutes ago, we thought that it was all for naught, and at this point, the simple reality is that the Rams are not out of it. Certainly not if you've watched the last 2 touchdown throws by Galani.
Well, now the question is, what do you do next week? Do you bring in Paul Galani? Do you start him quarterback, or do you stick with Greg Farland? Obviously, he's provided a bit of a spark. Granted, it may have been against the second unit of the Richmond defensive team, but still, I mean, he is an exciting player.
He's got my vote.
I'll join you. I believe he should be playing as well. You know,
Jeff Olivo will punt. Line of scrimmage is the 37. The punt will come from the 25. The twin safeties for the Rams outside their 25-yard line, as they have been all afternoon.
Ooh.
Pratt, a line drive punt to the far side of the field. It takes the spider bounce, fortunately for them, a flag way back upfield, and we may have, yes, we do have, a roughing the kicker, and the Spiders will get a first down. Once again, another bad break for Rhode Island. A flag well back in the backfield, indicated by the referee, Joel Goldman, and we think it will be an obvious roughing the kicker call.
Well, all they had to do is simply, you know, they're complaining in there, they put on a big heavy rush. All they had to do is just nick that ball with a fingernail, and they could have hit the kicker as hard as they wanted. But with all that pressure, he still was able to spice the ball right through everybody and get an effective kick. This little kicker is exciting to watch. He can boom the ball. I don't think he weighs 165 pounds.
Bob Blyer conversing with the coaching staff on the sideline as well.
The penalty has been declined. 1st and 10 for the
Rams. They declined the penalty.
Find that hard to believe.
Yeah.
You would think they would retain possession of the football. Nevertheless, they have elected to decline the penalty. So the Rams will take over, and they will own it deep in their own territory as a result of a very fortunate bounce. It was a poor punt, low line drive, but it took a huge bounce in the favor of the Spiders, and as a result, Galani and his offense go to work in their own territory at the 17-yard line. A minute 36 to play, 28-14. Richmond leads the University of Rhode Island. Galani to throw to the near side of the field. He's got a receiver out of the backfield is Morrill. Morrill to the sideline. Does not get out of bounds. They continue to wind the clock at the 27. First down for the Rams. They would have to stop it, I would think, to set the chains if, in fact, they pick up the first down.
I wonder why Richmond didn't want to hold on to the ball just to end the game. That's,
I can't understand that at all. I mean, it was fourth and 40 or whatever it may have been, 30 yards. Roughing the kickers, I believe, an automatic first down, unless it's only 15 yards, but I think it's an automatic first down, if I'm not mistaken.
And Galani to throw. Looking high and deep. Oh. The intended receiver on the far side of the field, Studley got a hand on it. Foster was standing behind it. It's a good thing that Studley did get a hand on it, because right behind him was one of the defensive backs for the University of Richmond. I believe that was Tony Butler, and he would have had an excellent opportunity to pick it off. Fortunately, Studley got a hand on it. It's incomplete, second and 10 football at the 29.
Back to the point we were making, I guess we were expecting URI to have the ball deep in the territory, taking more time to score, but with the explosiveness that they've shown in the past two scores, that wouldn't take too much time, maybe 15 seconds for a touchdown bomb.
Galani. Over the middle, it is complete to Studley. Studley out to his 45-yard line. Great throw by Galani. He got it over the linebackers and in front of the secondary, and as a result, the Rams have yet another first down. Clock will move once they set the football. We have 1:03 to play, and the football is in Ram territory at the 45-yard line. Galani looking for Potasik. He's got it. I don't believe he went inside. He didn't go to the out-of-bounds marker. He tried to cut back inside. And as a result, the clock will continue to move.
Well, these are the mistakes that you have. You know, things that are out in a rush a lot faster, they're playing, they're not really thinking of what they should be doing.
Unofficially, we have the Rams with 33 first downs as opposed to 26 for Richmond.
Double their average.
Fortunately, that effort did not reflect on the scoreboard. High and overthrown. Potasik takes a hit, and there will be a flag. There's definitely a late hit by Brian Jordan, and there should be a flag as the pass was well overthrown. And it was, there was no doubt that it was a cheap shot.
Well, the tempers are certainly getting flared here, and you can understand that URI
and Jordan right now is trying to use the excuse that he was just going up for the football. If we have another look at this, Kenny, it might be good to take a look. You don't like to see this at the end of a contest. There's no doubt that he need not have put the shoulder as he did this to Steve Potasik. It will definitely be a 15-yard walk-off, and it will give the Rams a first down in Richmond territory.
You're right, Mike. You've got a two-touchdown lead. Play the game right. There's no need to inflict any extra punishment on players. Rhode Island's played them hard and played them clean.
And so much for our editorial comment.
That's it.
Galani at quarterback. He owns the football in Richmond territory at the 38-yard line. 26 seconds, all that's left in the clock is moving. Overthrown, and it looked like it might have been picked off. The intended receiver was Pratt. In and out of the hands of Kim Pettis, and it bounced right off his numerals.
Well, whether it's positive or negative, Galani is exciting either way.
You can't really, I mean, your back's to the wall. You've got to throw up these happy balloons or whatever, and you hope that they're going to be received. The defensive players know that it's coming. An interception at this point has no bearing on the performance that this young man has shown me and some of the fans out here at URI.
Second and 10, 18 seconds, all that's left. Galani looks to throw, good pressure, almost get him. He evades the rush. Pass in the direction of Potasik overthrown. Four receivers downfield.
Right. Fight breaking out.
And once again, there's another fight breaking out. Galani lifted to the turf by
this
65
is ugly.
Troy Gray.
Over here.
Boy, this is ugly.
So the pictures will tell the story. We don't have to say much. The activity occurring right in front of the Richmond bench. And obviously, they've got the manpower strength in that situation. You don't have a rule like you do in hockey where a player comes over the board is automatically thrown out of the contest. So it's easy for some of those players to make their presence felt in a situation like that. With that, the referee is going to have to rule with an iron hand. You can't really call the game even with 12 seconds left because it's a 28-14 game. And the University of Rhode Island does have the football in scoring position, so I doubt very much that they can call the contest. They are, however, going to have to exercise some control, and I would be surprised. At this point, I would think the referee should be taking some numbers and perhaps ejecting some people to set some kind of a standard.
Well, you saw that Galani was even involved in that. He's a scrappy little kid.
He's defiant, your word.
He was being picked on by a guy that was about four times the size.
Tough little kid.
So now let's just hope that we can get these last 12 seconds over with a good performance by the University of Rhode Island Rams and Richmond. Let's not mar it by any more mistakes like this in any fights.
Completion to Studley. Studley looks the lateral. He does. Galani has it, and Galani has run out, not out of bounds, from behind. That's the same young man he had the problem with a minute ago, Troy Gray, who gang-tackled him on the far side of the field. And now, of course, some pushing and shoving, as you would expect on the Rams side. I doubt that these two teams will be exchanging pleasantries, as is so often the
exactly
case.
Exactly what I was thinking. You won't see a lot of players lining up at midfield shaking hands.
Another penalty flag, and you can only indicate that it's probably a roughing somebody.
This has been the longest 2 minutes in the history of football.
I think you're going a little bit overboard.
So we will wait the decision of referee Joel Goldman on the play. The football, as a result of the completion on the far side of the field in the lateral, would be, I see the flag on the far side, at about the 30-yard line, which is close to first down yardage. We have just 2 seconds on the clock, however, and Richmond with a comfortable 2-touchdown lead. They will win this football game. But it has been an exciting conclusion, certainly the last 5 minutes, generated by the young freshman quarterback, Paul Galani. You or I in the second half, 17 of 27 for 218 yards and a couple of touchdowns. Another walk-off, I believe, coming up as the referees converse at this point. It appears it will go against Richmond as they are huddling defensively at their own 15-yard line. Rams with certainly an opportunity to put yet another touchdown on the board here and close to within 7 points, and quite honestly, they deserve that. This is really, realistically, in terms of effort, about a 1-touchdown football game, and the Rams have put up quite an effort here today. Galani to throw. The clock has expired. This will be the last play. Football in the air. 5 white shirts in the vicinity. The intended receiver, 92 Mitchell, on the play. The pass is incomplete, and it is all over. The football game is over, and the University of Richmond has now moved to 4-3 on the season with a 28-14 win here at Meade Stadium in Kingston. As a result of their efforts here today, Richmond will move to 3-3, 500 in the contest, and unfortunately for the Rams, they are now 0-5 in league play and 0-7 on the season. And directly in front, almost like he is leading a band, Coach Bob Griffin has asked that all of his team members come directly in front of him. I'm sure that he doesn't want anybody going over into the general vicinity of where the Richmond team is until they have left the field. So it does not end on a pleasant note. That's a bit unusual because we have seen some games that have gotten well out of hand here in the last couple of years, but certainly that did not degenerate like this one did in the final couple of minutes.
Well, we've seen more competitive games worth more to URI than this one. It's hard to tell who really was at fault here. It is unfortunate. It mars an awfully exciting end of the game where we witness Paul Galani once again come in there and just do a marvelous job. Again, it brings us to the point as URI right now is at the 10-yard line to our left, and Bob Griffin is talking to him, his team right now.
As we take a look at one of the Ram touchdowns, they had 2 in the closing minutes. This one from Galani to Potasik. Unfortunately, a bit too little too late. The Rhode Island offense did not get underway until Galani took over, and that came with just 5-6 minutes left in the contest. They're able to put 2 scores on, and moved down to the 12-yard line. In fact, came within 12 yards of putting 21 points on the board. Nevertheless, as a result of the 28-14 defeat, they go down now to 0-7 on the season, as I mentioned. In addition, unfortunately, 0-5 in the conference.
There's a second touchdown, Mal. Galani, the defiant one he is, moving out of the pocket there and finding Emerson Foster.
I can't seem to say enough about the kid, and I hope to see, I wish him really well, and I hope that he gets some of the playing time that he justly deserves, and we'll see in the next couple of weeks what actually happens.
But scoring recap on the day, the 28 points for Richmond generated in the first half on a 57-yard interception returned by Tony Butler, and then a touchdown toss from Blyer to Irwin Matthews. It was 14-0 at the half. In the second half, they added two scores as they started. Their offense really got untracked and certainly generated much more in terms of total yardage. Through the first two quarters, the Rams defensively played a heck of a football game, and in the course of the contest, as I mentioned, many of their players I would think would be graded out highly. They had a great effort on the line on both sides of the ball here today.
They outplayed Richmond for a good portion of this game. It doesn't matter, though. The final score indicates that Richmond wins it 28-14.
Richmond can still look forward to something in the future. They've done well here. Maybe this is the beginning of the building blocks, the foundation to pick up and finish up with three more victories and have a respectable season nonetheless.
Rhode Island will have to buckle their chin straps as they go up to New Hampshire next week and take out a club that today started the day at 6-1-4. Richmond, they will have the pleasure of meeting Vince Dooley and the Georgia Bulldogs, and hopefully they will meet out some of the similar kind of fare that was the honor of Richmond to deal out here to the University of Rhode Island. Final score 28-14. Let's thank our sponsors. Today's game brought to you in part by the Providence Journal Bulletin. Tomorrow's another day. Read all about it. By Lincoln Greyhound Park, the exciting alternative. By Courtesy RV, we grow on customer satisfaction. By your Rhode Island AMC dealers. By Miller High Life, made the American way. And by Citizens Bank. So we conclude our Rollins Sports Network College Football 86 coverage for this afternoon from Meade Stadium in Kingston, Rhode Island. For Mal Najarian, Rich D. Simone, and for our statistician, Bob Rainville, and certainly our thanks as well to our spotter this afternoon, Tony Hill. I'm Mike Lyons. Once again, the final score from Meade Stadium, Richmond 28 and the University of Rhode Island 14. For this afternoon, have a good week, everybody.
Crazy cat.